What's up, everybody? This is Ming Chen from AMC's Comic Book Men, and you're listening to Nerd Thug Radio on IRLoneStar.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, your starting lineup for Nerd Thug Radio. At 5'8", the star, wingman, all-around expert of the show, the most important person in it, Cory DLG! Also featuring Joy Savage and Nico DLG.
Well, way to ruin the intro.
I nailed it.
There's no such thing as experts.
I don't think you nailed it at all.
I nailed it.
And I'm really disappointed that Nico just didn't let it run.
Forever.
You just let it run for a while.
It was about to build up to the part
the
where
guitars?
The guitar and the crescendo.
He
it was going to be awesome.
Yeah. He called himself an expert. There's no such thing as experts.
Five foot eight. That's a stretch.
I want to clarify.
We have our water girl with us today.
That's true. Special guest today, Mama Savage.
Mommy Savage. And her main objective in this show is we just had Cory DLG's birthday.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to take this time here to sing you a little happy birthday, DLG.
Happy birthday from Nerd Thug Radio.
You guys ready?
Let's get started.
All right, Nico DLG, you ready?
I'm prepared.
Here we go.
Happy birthday to you.
What is happening right now?
Happy birthday, Cory DLG.
Happy birthday to you.
Yeah, so,
That was amazing.
That was amazing.
I'd like to thank you guys, but I'm not going to because that was terrible.
You already did thank us. So
We appreciate it.
If we saw you guys out at the DLG Bash over the weekend, thanks for stopping by.
Yes, absolutely.
It was a pleasure. It was fun. It was real, but it wasn't pleasurably real fun, but we had a good time.
What happened?
Wow.
Did you just... I see what you did.
Yeah, I just went all there. I went all out.
Shoved them all together. Combinotron these words.
Combinotron.
It's your
boy,
Voltron.
So I was reading it. Speaking of Comptron and stuff.
Okay.
Computron.
The new Transformer movie. Like, I haven't really been paying attention to much of what's going on.
Yeah.
But they just announced today that King Arthur is going to be in it. So it's called The Last Knight. Transformer, I think The Last Knight or something like that.
Yeah, because, like, the primes are knights now.
Yeah, but King Arthur's in it.
Wait a minute. What?
Yeah, like,
yeah,
the,
I'm
they're
so
called,
confused.
Like, the prime knights. So, like, all, like, prime and, like, the other 13 other primes were all, like, knights.
Okay.
So are they time traveling, or is King Arthur coming to the future?
No, I mean, clearly
they did like a Night at the Museum kind of
right.
Night at the Museum.
Yeah, that would work.
That Night at the Museum Transformers crossover.
Oh man.
Way better than the Men in Black.
It's too bad Robin Williams is dead.
21 Jump Street.
Because that would be the greatest thing ever.
Oh man, that's really
Teddy
sad.
Roosevelt riding in on Optimus Prime.
Who's riding on a giant Tyrannosaurus.
Right.
Oh,
and
man.
That T-Rex is being chased by Grimlock, who's trying to hump it.
Yeah.
Like,
this
all the while
amazing.
Megatron's like over off in a corner like, this is way more stuff than I was not prepared for this.
They should have probably just let us write the movie.
Decepticons, let's just hit the bar because they won. Forget it.
It's over. They've got
they got two dinosaurs.
They've ceded Detroit to us. We'll take it.
And I'm out.
Okay, Nico, you know a lot. You're a pretty big nerd about the robots.
Transformers, the robots in disguise.
Have you been doing your research on the robots in disguise?
On the new movie, no.
Are they, in fact, more than meets the eye?
Sometimes they are, but not all the time. Okay. Sometimes they're very obvious, since like, okay, that's a Transformer.
Oh, okay. How many times have you seen that Transformer?
In person, at least twice.
Okay.
All right. Okay.
Okay.
There will be a drug test following the show. Thank you for participating.
You must pass. Or you're fired.
We saw one in Vegas.
We did see one in Vegas.
See? I'm not crazy.
We were in
here,
Vegas,
guys.
And there was a guy who was a bumblebee.
Oh, okay.
And it was pretty cool. I was like, I want to take my picture with him. And then I took it, and they said, oh, that'll be $5, please.
Yeah, we didn't realize you had to pay for those street people.
Yeah, that's how they make their living, guys. Yeah,
well. I mean, I don't charge people to take pictures with me.
You don't charge people money for money?
No.
All right.
Well, that's people, not the currency.
People want to take pictures with me. I'm not like, $5, please.
Oh, I do.
No, you don't.
Yeah, because you pretend to be Jonah Hill.
Yeah. And everyone always is like,
super bad.
Right, every time they review a movie, they're like, last time he was in Spring, he was kind of a huge douche. But otherwise, Jonah Hill's awesome.
Did you tell that story?
Yeah.
I mean, if you listen to any of the podcasts,
right,
you would know these things.
If you were a fan of the show, Mama Savage.
Yeah, no, you don't.
Yeah.
No, you just told her you half
this
listened.
Close from being exiled to the car.
I wanted her to listen to our funny Nico going back to school story last week. but we didn't make it. She tapped out. But I do have a new Nico back to school.
The new Nico back to school.
Zach, if you're listening, that was a great segue. Thank you very much.
You suck at segues.
So I asked Nico this week.
Here, let me set up the scene.
I want Nico to set the scene.
Okay,
up.
All right.
Hit us up, DLG.
So, candlelights.
Candlelight ceremony. I get up in the morning. I get dressed.
First week of school.
I'm ready.
He brushes his hair, brushes his teeth.
Brush my hair, brush my teeth.
I'm going to call a false on both.
He put on his best pair of corduroys.
And then I walked down the stairs.
Sweater vest.
Yep.
And then Dad's by the door. There's a sticky
bifocals.
Yep.
Dad's by the door. He opens it up and he's like, are you ready for your first day of school? Also, you're driving by yourself. All right, good luck. And I was like, all right, cool. So I get into my car.
So you drove all the way to school by yourself? No parental advisory?
Yeah.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah. So I drive
no wonder
to school.
It was a scary drive for you.
So I drive all the way to school, and I get there. I park in, the very back because I didn't feel like struggling for parking. Because
he needed to get his exercise in for the day.
Exactly. So I walk all the way across
solid
campus,
choice.
Find my class, and then realize I have, about an hour and a half before I have to do anything. And I was like, I left a little bit way too early. So I'm walking around campus. I just find my other classes, and then I go to my
I'm going to give you. That's a smart move there.
That was.
Most people would have just sat outside on their phone playing, but you took the time to walk around, find your other classes so you would
familiarize yourself with the route.
Hey, man, some of us is rubbing off on you.
Mentally mark all your emergency exits.
Way to go.
Exactly.
Okay.
Right. So I walk into the building, and I'm like, hey, where is
found
this
room? Found the snack
shop. Yeah, found the vending machines there. And I was like, cool. I have no money. Awesome. So I walk upstairs. I find
sponsored
my classroom.
Sponsored Nerd Dog Radio.
Right.
I find the classroom, and I'm waiting there, and there's about two other people outside the door. I'm like, okay, so, you know, they got about 20 minutes till the class starts. We're just super early. And then, 10 minutes passes. Some more people show up. 15 minutes. More people. There's about 12 of us sitting outside the classroom door now.
From 15 to 12 and no teacher.
And there's no teacher. The class started 10 minutes ago, so we're all waiting.
This sounds like a scary movie start.
So this is excessive, right?
Sounds
we see
like a
there's
dream
teachers.
To me.
Yeah.
Teachers are coming up and they're walking right past the door and they're like, okay, obviously these aren't the people we need.
Right.
And then
these are not the students you're looking for.
These aren't the classrooms you're looking
these
for.
These aren't the classrooms you're looking for.
We wait there for about 30 minutes outside this classroom after class should have
started. See, now, we discuss this. 10 minutes, I'm done.
Yeah, I give... My rule is 15 minutes.
Yeah, so no call, no show. I'm out.
So boom. The collective students that are there, the 12 or 15 of us that were there, we get up and we're like, we out. See you guys next week. Or see you guys later this week. So we all leave. Me, this one guy, go downstairs. We go and talk to the info desk.
Because Nico has scoped the place out. He knows where everything is at this point.
Well
so
done.
We find the info desk.
So proud of our little Eagle Ranger.
So.
We walk over.
You're not a pad one much
we,
longer.
We meet up with one of the other girls who just walked out.
Ooh.
She cute? What'd she wear?
Is she single?
I don't know.
DLG needs to hook her up with Cory.
So we go down.
I mean, he can handle
does
it.
Does she
can
have
do
a
himself.
Tinder?
Right.
Yeah,
or an
the
Uber.
Real question. So we walk down to the dean's office, and we ask them, and they're like, oh, well, that's weird. It's like, there's a class in there for Wednesday. And it's like, no, not none of our schedules say today, Wednesday. And we're like, okay, what's going on there? And then she's like, guys, it's a late start. Doesn't start till the 26th. And then all of us are collectively just like
so
throw our
15,
head in our hands.
This 15-minute story he just told to set it up, basically Nico didn't read. He took the time to
no,
find
no,
the whole
hang
place.
On. To be fair, I don't want to even lump Nico in. Somewhere there's 12 other idiots.
Yeah, 12 people decided not to
read
the schedule to realize class doesn't start till the end of the month.
The
26th.
So just so we're clear, today, recording, right now, it
31st.
Is Thursday, September 1st.
And that was...
You're 24 days off, 25 days off, somewhere around there.
You were a little early, buddy.
So we got there, and the funny part is that it wasn't just like, oh, it was like two people. It was literally 15 people just waiting outside this
See,
door.
See, and that would really mess me up, because here's my rule in college. Like, if 4 to 7 people assemble in the same place, then I'm not wrong. Like, I'm like, okay, well, obviously we're all here together waiting for the same thing.
You guys were all wrong.
12 of you managed to not figure it out.
12 people managed not to look
here's,
at the schedule.
Here's what I recommend doing when class starts. Sit nowhere near any of those 12 people.
Do not friend those people.
Do not friend those people. Do not copy their homework or notes because they are clearly the dumb ones.
So then after some more cluster inspection, I was like, oh, sweet. My next class on Friday doesn't start till next Friday. Cool.
Yeah, then he took the time to look at his schedule. I thought everyone started school this week. It's not high school anymore.
Yeah, I know, right?
You got different start times.
So wait, so did you drive home like 5 hours early and Dad's like, what are you doing here?
Yeah, I called him. I was like, yeah, class doesn't start till the 26th. And he's like, oh, Okay, I'll see you at home then.
Come help me take over the world. Get back, so I get back to your post, Nico.
I get back and I'm like, hey, do you want me to go get lunch or something? And he's like, yeah, take these Burger King coupons. I was like, all right.
Oh, you're using my King coupons?
Yeah.
Oh.
You shouldn't have left them there.
I did. I left a whole sheet. Like, it's like $200 worth of Burger King coupons.
So
there's some really good deals on there.
I know.
One of my favorite college stories.
Jerk.
I go to freshman orientation.
All
right. There's like 200 of us there, right? And we have to take this, like, math exam.
Not the TSI.
No. It's basically, if you pass it, you can take college algebra. If you don't, then you have to take some remedial intro to college math class.
Are you stupid? You go here.
Yeah.
Are you smart?
So
go here.
We all take the test, and then we all file into this room, and they start calling names out of people.
Oh, shit.
And about the fifth name, my name gets called. So I get up. So back in, I'm going to college. I've got the long blonde hair.
Right, right.
I'm wearing, a big, silver fake peace and chain necklace.
Right.
I kind of look like a slouch almost. And so I get into the room and
what
later
is this almost. You look like a slouch.
So later on, some of the people I befriended, they were like, as soon as we heard your name, like, oh God, those must be the people that didn't pass this test. So we get to this room and there's like 20 of us, and we're the only 20 that actually passed the test. I'm just looking around. It's like suckers.
Suckers.
Don't judge the book, man.
Actually kind of a similar thing. So when I went to orientation, I went to University of Alabama. And so,
he said that like 12 times in this podcast, not this specific one, but every time he talks about college, like, I went to the University of Alabama.
Because I didn't have
one year.
I didn't have the, like, I like community college a lot more than I liked university. I really did. But so you see the difference when you do those things. So when you go to the big schools, like University of Alabama,
the Dallas Baptist University.
Oh, okay. So it's not really a big school, but it's bigger than a community college.
It's bigger than a
marginally.
No. Yeah, it is.
Probably than some.
It's way more expensive.
That's the important part. And it doesn't have the high school vibe.
So when you're at the orientation, they do have you take some tests, and they kind of weed you into the groups and all that. And so we're doing the scheduling, and I'm sitting with the other kids that are in the advanced honors programs, and then they're also on the engineering branch of it, which is what I was in. And so I'm sitting there looking around,
and you're the only white person there?
I just realized how completely different I was from all of those folk. Like, I was wearing contacts back then. I was wearing like a cartoon Transformers shirt.
Yeah,
like,
nice.
I was nerded out, but like me, I was already me at this point. And these kids were like the Coke bottle glasses, the pocket protectors. These were the hardcore. Like, they studied super hard to get where
that's
they were.
That's all they did was
and
just
I'm sitting
study.
In this room and I'm looking around at these 10 or 12 kids and I'm thinking to myself, holy crap, what did I get myself into? Like, please don't room me based on this. Like, there's nothing good that can come of this.
Nothing good at all.
It wound up being really interesting. They actually roomed us. I wound up being roomed based on common interest, and they lumped us all in because our common interest was we weren't from Alabama.
Oh, okay.
There were
so
few of us that were going to school there outside of the University of Alabama that they had one dorm essentially for basically the out-of-towners.
They were like, let's not put these people with all the rednecks. They won't know how to handle it.
Right. These are the people who came here thinking we're prestigious.
So these are the guys who aren't going to join the fraternity. Let's put them in their own place.
Right. So it was a lot of fun, but the interesting thing was just how, like, we had to learn about Alabama together. Like, they have it's just different. The cigarette age is 19, not 18.
Okay.
So all the hipster kids who already smoke
but
at 18 in college.
Age is like 12.
The alcohol age was like free. Like, they don't even charge you. They just set it outside the gas station. You just put it in your truck and drive off.
And here we go.
Is that not what it's for?
No, that's not what happens.
Oh.
Here we go.
Probably more than one warrant in the state of Alabama.
And that's why you haven't been back.
Yeah.
Since you left.
Yeah, that is true. But so it was just a different. You're right. When you're sitting in that orientation room, and you're looking around, and you're like, "Oh crap!
What am I doing here?"
Right.
You go to community college. You're like, "Yep, I'm better than all these people."
I loved taking night classes at community college.
That wasn't a good idea for me.
No.
I was telling Nico by like my junior year, I was making money, and so I wasn't as interested in school anymore.
True.
But I was like, I'm going to try to make my schedule as easy as possible. Here's one class. I can go to it only Wednesday nights for 2.5 hours once a week. Perfect. Yeah, that didn't work out too well. Because you miss one class, you're behind the whole week. And it's like, oh, it's only 2 hours, not bad. But then like 30 minutes before class, you're like, holy duds, I'm going to be there for 2.5 hours. Nah, I'm done.
Yeah, like,
One
thing about community college is it's really easy to, you kind of said it, high school-ish. It's really easy. If you go during the day, it's really easy to kind of fall into, like, silly patterns, like where you make fun of the teachers, or you just talk and you're not there to learn.
And you make friends.
But the reality is, you're paying for this education. You're spending your money to sit there.
There's another point. Keep going.
So I liked the night classes because I would get there and it'd be the soccer moms, and it'd be like,
that's why you liked going to night classes.
Oh, yeah. No, but it would be the people there who were there to take it serious, but like they were already adults. They're grown ups.
Right, right.
They're not like, yeah, they're gonna be friendly and nice, and if they need help or if they can give help, but they're not there to like. They're not there because they have to be there. They're there because they want to be there. And so that experience is way different. It's so much better.
So we were both class clowns in our respective high schools.
Absolutely.
Look me up in yearbook, Oak Ridge 2002. You'll find my silly mug there under class clowns. But when I got to college, and even now, like the workplace, like the class clown bit annoys the crud out of me, man.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
I hated when we were in college and like they want to make the wisecracks. Or like when we're at meetings at work, and there's always the one yahoo that like wants to make funny suggestions in the back and try to be the class clown. It's not high school anymore, man. Like,
right.
Some people are here because they want to be, and they need this, and they need to pay attention. I mean, anybody can get through high school,
right?
Even with my jokes and trying to be funny. But once you get to college, the workplace, let's get through this meeting as fast as possible so we can go about our business.
Right, yeah. To me, less college, but I don't like it in college, because you're right. We're paying for that time. It's now on our dime.
Exactly.
Work especially. I can't stand it because it's like, and I have fun at work. I make jokes, and I play with
my coworkers. Oh, I have a great time, too, but once it's time to get serious and you're in a meeting setting.
In meetings and things like that, man, let's just get out of this stuff.
I mean, I joke around all the day on the sales floor, out in the warehouse with the guys. Right. But once meeting time comes, I don't want to be in here. Let's get this over with. Right.
This isn't how ASAP. We make our money. This
especially
isn't how
we make when
our
money. There's an outside source,
right,
or somebody from a different branch coming in to do the meeting. Let's just get it over with.
Let's be respectful of their time.
This is why I'm kind of happy. I live so far away because basically all my friends went to the same campus and they're all there in the mornings. And it's basically like I was like, it's like 13th grade over here.
Grade 13.
Right. Yeah. No. Yeah. Although this will test your friend making skills.
Yeah. Make some friends, Nico.
Yeah. Start some clubs. Run for president.
So earlier perfect. Nico mentioned Tinder.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I got proposed the question yesterday. Is Uber the new Tinder?
Yeah, you texted me this, and I don't understand exactly what you're
saying. So let me set it up.
I'm very confused.
So me and the Mommy Savage are in the CVS.
Very confused.
Down the street. And the night manager that's in there, younger kid, pretty cool. I always talk to him every time I go in there. And so we went in there to literally get pull-ups and toilet paper. And we come
up. I thought
up
you had mastered this, man.
Yeah, I know. Me too. We walk up with two packs of pull-ups, a pack of toilet paper, bean dip, shredded cheese, Fritos.
You guys were into some stuff.
A pack of nuts. What else did we pick up?
My awesome paper towels.
Paper towels, like hand napkins for the bathroom and stuff.
Okay, okay.
And so we're just putting out. I'm like kind of like, ugh, the whole time just being stupid. And the guy's kind of giggling. I was like, this is why you don't pick up hitchhikers. Because 10 years later, you're married with two kids, and you can't go anywhere.
Right. No,
and so
no,
he just kind of starts laughing. He's like, so I shouldn't pick up hitchhikers? I was like, no, man. He's like, well, what if I'm Ubering? He's like, is Uber like the new Tinder now? And so it brings us full circle. So I text you, and I asked you this question, and you seemed pretty perplexed yet interested about this statement.
Because, like, having utilized both apps.
See, this is why I wanted to discuss this, because you've Ubered and you've Tindered.
True.
You're an Uber Tinderoni.
I am the Uber Tinderoni.
An Uber Tinderoni. That should be your new screen name.
The Uber Tinderoni.
Uber Tinderoni. Hashtag Uber Tinderoni.
Hey, guys, it's fake Scott Baio here.
Yeah.
I like to swipe right on this ride.
So, as a driver, like, okay, so I've only picked up, like, three people. One of them was a young professional.
Ever you only did
I did
it
I literally did it for
times.
One weekend.
He did it well. He did it for multiple times. But when you first started, you almost got your license suspended because you went downtown when you weren't supposed to.
Right.
Without a fire extinguisher or a permit.
So the city of Houston made some extreme regulations. This is really the first time I've ever heard the Republican argument be true that
they tried to protect
regulation
the taxi
cancel small business, and that's exactly what they were doing. They were protecting the taxis because taxis come standard with fire extinguishers, and the taxi drivers already have their permits and licenses, and the cabs are maintenance regularly and
permitted.
Well,
they've got a ton of insurance on them, too,
because
they're not owned by them.
So, to me, okay, now when Uber first started, I actually said to a friend that legally this seems like a huge liability in a lot of ways. Drunk driving, serial killers, things of this nature. Seems like Uber
along the lines of Craigslist.
Right. Seems like Uber could really be opening, but more, because Uber matches the driver to the rider.
Correct.
So to me, that actually is an even bigger assumption of liability, because let's say, Allie, you're the rider, Uh-huh. You're downtown. You've had a lot to drink, uh-huh. but you were already going to Uber. You already had this planned.
Uh-huh.
You get in the app. You push it. You set go. It's like my second time driving ever. Uber says they know me because I passed the background check, but maybe I just haven't been arrested for all those dead bodies in my cabin yet.
Yeah, absolutely.
So then I pick you up. I serial kill you. You're the one I get caught on. Now your family gets to sue Uber for, like, millions.
What if taxi drivers do that?
Well, but...
Who are they going to sue? The taxi driver company as well?
Yes,
same,
no,
same concept.
Except taxis are so heavily insured.
Yeah, I think they go through a lot of...
If she got drunk
strenuous.
Downtown, she would just call me and I'd go get her.
Right,
okay,
but...
Okay, well, that's on the point.
Because it happened to me once. I got stranded downtown. She came and got me.
Oh, that's sweet.
Thank you.
Thanks for not calling me, because I would have called Allie and she would have come and got you.
Hey, go get your husband.
Yeah, he's
now.
Calling me. And
it's better than
it's...
the one time he got arrested and I went and partied instead of getting
yeah,
out of jail.
Yeah, that happened as well.
True story.
This is a family show, so let's not get into my past life.
Let's be clear.
Get into the details.
No one wants to know how I actually became Joey Savage. They just want to know that I am Joey Savage.
Right. It involves scenes from the movie Oz. The show Oz. But Uber to me has always assumed a huge liability that I think they've really kind of, they underplay it publicly, but I got to think that somewhere they're getting some legal advice that just tells them, shut this stuff down. But so the city of Houston.
They're still going strong, though.
They really are. And the city, actually, they lost an estimated $1.3 billion last year. So that's actually affecting kind of their valuations. They were going to go public, and now they're kind of afraid of it because their revenues.
Now there's other ones. Like there's a thing called, I think, an app called Lyft.
Well, and Lyft has actually always existed, and the thing that's interesting is Lyft and Uber go city to city, and they fight for domination of it, and there are some Lyft cities, and there are some Uber cities.
I would like to see a Lyft and Uber celebrity death match on MTV.
That would be great.
That'd be awesome.
So I guess we got crazy sidetracked here, but at the end of the day, the city of Houston really made it really hard to be an Uber driver, so I only did it for one weekend because...
You're supposed to get a license.
I was supposed to do a bunch of stuff with the city of Houston in order to pick up in Houston that I didn't do. Including have like a little taxi blue permit thing on my car, which also in order to get it you had to pass inspections.
And all that stuff too, and
right? Yeah. No, I did
fire
pass
extinguisher.
Like seven background checks with Uber. So Uber does
amazingly.
Run some, they do run some thorough background checks, not thorough enough. You know what I'm saying, ladies?
Holla.
Not thorough enough. But
I am Batman.
The problem is the city of Houston really kind of overregulated it so that Uber wouldn't threaten the taxis, and so I was downtown. And I was supposed to be picking up this girl, and she's drunkenly yelling to her friend, I think this is our Uber! I think this is him! This is him! This is our Uber! And there was happened to be a cop like walking right down the street at the time, and he looked at me, and he pounded on my hood, and he goes, hey, you! Out of the car! And I was like, oh, man, what is going on?
This is the end of me.
Yeah. Should have paid that parking ticket.
So the girls immediately turn around and walk off, and so I'm like, yes, sir? And he first thing out of his mouth is, where's your blue tag? And I was like, I don't know what that is, sir. I'm an Uber driver. And he goes, you're supposed to be licensed with the city. You get a blue permit. And I was like, oh. I said, he goes, you need to go back wherever you came from, and you don't pick up. If I see you in the city of Houston again tonight, I'm writing you a ticket, and it'll cost you over
$400. So why does that Uber
you said,
warn
swipe
you?
Left.
Uber does, but it also still lets you pick up riders.
Yeah, exactly. Why doesn't it say, oh, you're not authorized?
It should, but again, like I said,
there's
Uber's
a fail
open.
Safe. They're, man.
Uber's open
why
to
didn't
a
someone
lot
else
of,
think of
a
that?
A lot of liabilities. Like I'm telling you, I really think Uber... As an idea is great, as an executed concept it.
Yeah, there's a lot of great ideas, but how to execute them properly
right.
is a
and
total
so,
different ballgame.
And so, like, it's really interesting. The two rides I did have successfully with Uber, I live by the airport. I drove in town, picked two people up who were going to the airport. So I drove right back where I came from. I had a really fun conversation with them. The other one was a young professional. And she literally was in her phone the whole time and didn't speak to me at all. And I was a cab driver.
So Ubering and Tinder
but
probably don't mix
really
well.
Isn't it really expensive
no.
to Uber?
No, not really. Actually, it was probably...
It's not any different than taxi
yeah,
cabbing.
The couple, actually, that I drove to the airport, we had a really cool conversation. They came down for a surprise wedding, which as a concept to me is a failed
surprise
idea.
Surprise shotgun wedding.
No, shotgun. Like, they'd been dating for like 8 years, and she thought this was going to be an engagement party, and then... When he gets on one knee and engages himself to her or asks her to marry him, her parents and his parents walk through the door also, and then there's a priest.
So she didn't even get a dress. So he went the cheap route and
well,
didn't buy her a
I don't know about cheap
dress.
Route because he held it here in Houston, like flew everybody in from all these. They all live in different.
That was all so he didn't have to pay for a big wedding. You know how expensive a wedding is? He went the cheap route.
I mean, maybe, but
I would have said no.
Corey probably doesn't because he hasn't been married yet.
Right, like right now, all I'm thinking about is like way to ruin this guy's like huge romantic.
Yeah,
he flew in like 20 people, including her parents
from
and
Tibet.
A priest.
Yeah,
in
on
Australia.
His his work credit card that he had all these points.
I had all these flyer miles.
Oh, man.
Listen, we started this before the show. She's a Debbie Downer, man.
She is a Debbie Downer.
There's a Debbie Downer. Unless you're talking about Green Tea and Three Musketeers, she's not smiling.
Right. Mama Savage, the nag.
Yeah, whoa.
The nag is strong.
Yep.
Yep.
Yep. So yes. I guess Uber and Tinder probably.
No, because like
so how'd that work? Like you well, they should have like pictures on the Uber, and then you can swipe left or right if you want to pick you up.
The thing that's really awkward is they see a picture of me, and you know me. Like, I don't take great photos.
Yeah, so like this guy?
And it's a tiny photo, swipe so like right. All they see is a beard and a pair of glasses in this tiny photo.
That's why you got the beard. I love the beard. Yeah. Swipe right.
And so they definitely...
Like, ooh, a foreigner. That feels like home.
What I'm swipe left.
What I want here is a Pakistani man to drive me to the airport and not
swipe
speak to
left.
Me. But, so like I said, with the couple from all the way to the airport, we had this really interesting conversation about Uber, because they were actually my very first pickup. So we're having this fun conversation about like the charging and all that. And I asked him, I said... You know, I see what I'm going to get when I accept the ride. I said, so, you know, why did you choose Uber? And so he was like, oh, you know, I was, you know, we looked at everything. He said, trust me, you know, we're two young college, recently graduated young professionals. He said, we evaluate everything. He said, but this was cheaper than the cab ride by about $10.
Over-evaluate.
So I was like, okay, all right.
I'll take it.
Yeah. And I'll swipe right here and win.
Yeah. And they tipped me also and gave me 5 stars.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Nice. High quality.
The unprofessional lady also gave me 5 stars. And then on her comment, she put, nice ride.
And then you never
I think
Ubered
it's because
again?
We literally didn't speak.
And that was the end of your Uber career.
That was. Because the third ride.
Hey, that means you got a 100% five-star.
You went out on top, man.
That's right. I am a retired
five-star
Uber driver.
You always want to go out on
so
top.
Do you have to quit or you just don't do it anymore?
I just didn't do it. Now, the one thing Uber does do that's super creepy is they text you from this number. So I guess they have like a marketing guy down here who's like pushing Uber here to the drivers. So like he'll text you. He'll be like, hey, man, we're heading – they had a word for it, a blitz or a rush where it was like super expensive right then because there were so many ride requests and so few drivers that the rides were 3 times more the average cost.
Awesome. That's good stuff.
So he would be like, hey, man, we're having
supply
a rush.
Supply and demand.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes, exactly. It was a perfect example of market capitalization in that instance. So like
– God, we're nerdy.
Yeah. So like supply and demand was literally running the pricing for Uber. If it was equal, if there were more drivers than riders, it's in the rider's favor. If there's fewer drivers than riders, it's in the driver's favor. So that's how it works with Uber. But yeah, it would be like, hey, we're having a rush right now in the southeast section of downtown Houston. If you could be there in 10 minutes, you'll probably make $50. It's like the thing that would text you. And so, in an hour. So you'd be like, oh, okay. But you would just get these random texts. Like, I'd be at work, and my phone would buzz with a text message.
Or you'd be with a Tinderoni.
Right. Trying to get my Tinder wrong.
I got to go, girl. I got to go Uber.
Oh, dang, girl. You ain't got $200 on you, do you?
You should put that in your profile. Retired 5-star Uber driver. Yeah.
Oh, man, you're
that'd
right.
That'd be awesome.
Wouldn't right.
That's enhancing your the experience there.
Right. The resume is sexier.
Just bring that resume up, bruh. Mm. 5-star retired Uber driver, Cory DLG.
So you said my own comic shop. I put that on my resume because, you know, I was proud of it. That was a good 9 months where I also don't feel like explaining a work gap where it's like, what'd you do for 9 months? And I was like, nothing, you know, just like, out.
Tendered.
Yeah, tendered. Tendered like a pro. No, you know, and it, you know, have my own store, but you definitely, I put that, just talking about resumes, I put that on the resume because it's really hard to explain work gaps.
I put my Taekwondo belt rank on my resume.
I think you should.
I do.
Texas champion.
Texas State Taekwondo sparring champion.
My purple belt.
But you got to put in parentheses, points.
Points. Point. John points. Claude Van
points
Damme
sparring.
Style.
Yeah. Because what if they're like, hey, I'm a fighter.
Hey,
we
my fight's coming
spar.
Up soon. My fight's coming up soon.
Oh, yeah?
No, I'm just kidding.
Hey, actually, you know my buddy kids. James? James the Smasher Hatcher.
James the Smasher Hatcher, October
friend
1st,
of the
right?
Show. That's right. He's got a fight coming up October 1st. I'll try and get him here in the studio here towards the end of the month, and then we'll also maybe hopefully give away some more tickets for that down the
maybe.
Road.
We'll see.
We'll reach out. Yeah, we've got to find out.
Nerdbug Radio.
Is there a movie this is in?
Lone Star Community Radio is Montgomery County's community radio station, and we are looking for talk show hosts and volunteer DJs for our music shows. Are you interested in having your own talk show on Lone Star, or have you always wanted to live out your dreams of being a music DJ? With the addition of Conroe's FM 104.5 and 106.1 and video aspects of our talk shows, we are needing people to grow with us. If you or someone you know might be interested, please contact us online at irlonestar.com/contact us or call the station at 936-647-5747 for more information.
Reba.
Reba, put that stank on it.
We are Nerd Thug Radio.
Hoo-wee!
We got so excited last segment, we didn't even do any of our, like, here we are. But yeah. I'm the captain of the show, so that'd be like the point guard, Joey Savage, the man of the paint, Cory DLG.
I'm the star of the show.
The water boy, Nico DLG. Yeah.
It's your boy here.
And the cheerleader, Mommy Savage, hanging
Wait,
out with
have
us.
Cheerleaders?
Well, that one.
Oh.
You know that cheerleader that's on the team but doesn't want to be on the team because she's super emo? And
like just on the bench?
Yeah.
Gets really excited every time we make a shot, though?
Yeah. No, not that one.
Oh.
The one that just...
The one next to that one?
Because the town, there's only like 30 kids in the class, so there's only 4 cheerleaders, and she has to be one because she's one of the girls.
Right.
And they're emo still, and they listen to punk rock. So they're just sitting there like, yeah. I'd rather be doing art and slitting my wrist.
Yeah,
that's Mommy Savage.
Yeah.
That's okay. Our cheerleader. See, she gets it.
That sounds about
got
right.
Got pretty vivid there.
Wow.
Yeah. It wouldn't. You kept going.
Yeah.
I mean, things just kept popping up into my head. So
I was waiting for you to stop because you're married to
rolling with it. Just kept rolling with it.
Just kept going.
He likes living in the doghouse.
Well, I wasn't specifically describing her as a person at that point. It was more of just the persona I was going after.
The persona for there?
Yeah.
I was just describing her persona.
So we have a website now.
Yeah.
NerdThugRadio.com.
That's the place.
We are
.comming it, bros. So go on that website, check it out. There's pictures up there. You can contact us through it.
Yeah, you could see us naked on it.
No, you can't.
No?
Each one of our
illustrious
host.
I sent you like 12
pictures. Nobody wants to see any part of you unclothed.
I sent like 15 pictures of my D to your wife.
You should probably. Wait. No wonder she was in such a bad mood all day.
Yeah, I would be too.
But yeah, we all have a blog on there, so you can kind of see what goes on inside of our heads when we're not doing the show.
It's a dark, scary place.
Corey's will be very
in the winter ruins.
Smart and nerdy, like
probably
witty.
Zach will have one as well.
Our friend Zach Attack.
Mine's pretty lame. It just covers the 3 Bs: beers, babes, and bands.
I like that though. That's perfect.
There's no thinking about it. Just look at the beer of the month, the lady of the month, and the band of the month.
Wait a minute, of the month. What kind of blogger
or
do you think you're doing? Yeah,
or the month.
He's like the month.
If I have time to do, yeah,
guys,
bi-weekly. That's like, no, I'll probably do it once a week.
Guys, I did
bees.
My blog. Where are y'all?
I did. Yeah, I completed mine first.
Yeah,
hey,
yeah.
He
made the easy one fast.
Yes.
Yeah,
it's been 3 weeks, Joey.
My babe of the month though is our babe of the week is Ruth Nega, who is on Preacher. So you guys should go check that out.
Okay, not where I would have gone with that, but okay. All right.
Well, I've been binge-watching Preacher this week.
Yeah,
Mommy
no,
Savage.
I just would have picked somebody attractive as all.
She's That's very funny. Attractive. I find her very attractive. And she's kind of a little badass.
She is very tough. However, do not find her attractive at all.
Did you know that her and Dominic Cooper have been dating for the last, like, 6 years?
Swipe
what?
It. Dominic Cooper could have some quality.
And they've been dating since 2010, I believe.
Poor Dominic Cooper.
Now they're starring on the show together.
And now he's in a show called Preacher where he'll never get any again.
I have a feeling
they're both
she
on Preacher.
Beats him up.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Right? Like she's like, yeah.
Absolutely.
He's like, babe, I don't know what accent that was. I really don't know. Babe.
But we still have the Facebook page too. So check us out, facebook.com/nerdthugradio.
Check us out on Instagram.
You can get to all those on the website.
On the website.
There's
oh,
links.
Yeah?
But
there's
more
links.
Importantly, we are Nerd Thug Radio on irlonestar.com.
Yes.
Soon and very, very soon to be.
Well, right now, if you're hearing us on the radio, no?
No.
Oh.
So very
soon.
What
about right now?
No, not right now.
Soon. Now?
Probably not this episode, but the next episode.
Check it now.
The next episode will probably be
check it now.
The radio. This is episode 22.
Check it now.
I would say episode 23, maybe 24.
Check it now.
What about now?
Nope, not now.
Okay, so what you're doing right now, go to your radios, 104.5 FM.
It's going
to
be 106.1 first.
Or 106.1.
Because Corey doesn't pay attention.
No, I was just giving them both options. I go numerically
Sister
order.
Sister Station.
Right.
106.1 is going first. It'll be up running full blast in a couple weeks.
But so, yeah, just check right now. Check right now.
But nothing.
Check right now.
And I'm checking. Nico, you checking?
No.
Nothing.
Yeah, okay, but like, what if someone's listening to us like 3 weeks from now?
Yeah, 3 weeks from now. Now
see,
you can find us.
See what I'm doing?
Now you
see?
Can do it. Now you
Who's
can
the
do
brains here?
Not
Who's
you.
The star?
We also have a new t-shirt design.
Check it now.
Female and male. Corey, what's that web address to our t-shirts?
What?
It's going to be on the website.
It's on the website.
We're
going to
link it from
the
website also. It's divineoutlawboutique.com.
Just go to the website and find it.
Yeah. Go to the website. So there's going to be a link on the website.
There's like a shop till you drop app.
A shop till you drop app.
Click it.
Can I make a recommendation?
To her.
Can it be a shop while you lay around app?
Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
That's more your style.
Yeah, because I'm already, I drop pretty early.
And when you drop hard.
Yeah.
And then the snoring begins.
Hard.
And then no one else around you can sleep.
Hard.
That's why you can't stay the night at my house anymore.
No, you're not hard. House.
He stays at our house.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's literally on the other side of the house, and we can still hear him.
We can still hear him.
One this time, is how bad I feel. None. None at all.
So, Nico, one time, Cory comes over on a Sunday, and we're going to go do some clicks action.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And he falls asleep on the couch.
Yeah.
So we're supposed to be there at 4:30. At 4 o'clock, I started attempting to wake him up, and he is just pal driving these snores, man, left and right. He wouldn't even wake up. It got to the point where me and little Sadie Savage were literally hitting him in the face with pillows for about 5 minutes. Until he finally came to. And then he got the look on his face like, is the world ending? Is the world over? No, dude, it's just time to go. Oh. And he slowly, you know, gingerly
the
wakes
sheer
up.
Sheer disappointment that I felt.
It was going to be all over. It's,
right.
That's where the excitement was coming from.
Right.
So I texted you boys this week.
You did?
And I said, I'm starting my Rick and Morty marathon.
Yes.
Such a good show.
I'm in episode 3.
Good old Mick and Rorty.
So I start watching a little bit
of
it with
good old Short and Blorty.
With Mommy Savage.
And Rick and Morty.
She is not a fan of the Rick and Morty by any chance. She's like, what is this?
Get on the next level.
This isn't even funny.
This is the future of hilarious animation.
It's not.
It really is.
It's not.
They went to the level of to not have any of their pupils be circles.
You know,
nice.
Robot Chicken just ruins all of everything else for me.
It's nothing like Robot Chicken.
So, I don't know. It's just... That was so much funnier than
this one's
is.
Way better than
Robot Chicken's Chicken. Great, but Robot Chicken's great because it references pop culture icons.
This is original and new.
This is completely original and new
and boring.
And just, but they also it blows my mind the stuff they do in that show. I'm always like, oh, that's so great.
It's really good.
She only watched about 5 minutes.
Okay, see, you only watched 5 minutes.
That's all I could get through.
Yeah, it's like
go watch the episode of Rick's Minutes.
Like, it was like me trying to watch SLC Punk 2. 5 minutes was.
Or anything Star Trek related.
Yeah, 5 minutes.
Go watch the episode of Rick's Minutes. It's a good one.
Okay. Let's try that one. We'll try that one,
I'll
Mommy
give
Savage.
It 5 more minutes. If someone find me a good episode, and I'll give it 5 more minutes.
You'll do as we tell you, and we tell you to watch it.
So, some nerd news this week.
Yeah, yeah.
That World of Warcraft thing
Legion.
Launched. Legion, the new
expansion.
Expansion?
So, I think they're at 90, like max level 95, which means there's
nothing.
Only one more max level expansion to go, and then they're done.
I know nothing.
What do you mean? Like, have they publicly
it.
Said they're only going to get 200?
Yeah, that's why
I know
it,
nothing
80,
about
like,
World of Warcraft
6 or 7 years ago.
Nothing about
so
it. I've never played it. But our friend Rusty,
yeah,
when he found out the release date, which they released it. How long ago they released this release date? Like 3 or 4 months ago,
probably.
He went ahead and took off the whole week of work. He told me. So I'm taking off the whole week of World of Warcraft. I'm going to sit and binge play it the entire time.
Okay, I respect
while
that.
While I eat pizza
I mean,
off my chest and
oh,
pump.
Yeah.
Pump
Excuse
my
me,
veins
sir,
full
why
of
are
gravy.
You taking
oh, yeah.
a week off of work?
I'm going to play video games, mother truckers.
Oh, yeah.
that's exciting.
Life
no,
goals.
I'm okay with that. Like, they do this. They do, like, the fun stats when Madden's come out, how, like, X amount of sick days are taken, this
yeah.
X amount of sick hours, blah, 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 stuff like that. Lost productivity to March Madness, you know, things like that. I love those stats because it just shows that everyone on some level gets into these things. There's something that
oh,
everybody
yeah,
gets into
yeah.
and cares about and has some fun with.
Definitely.
So World of Warcraft is kind of an interesting thing. When it came out...
1985.
Yeah, it seems like it, right? Like,
back
right?
in the
it's
early
around,
60s when World of Warcraft was released.
It's been around forever. So it was the first MMORPG that really
For all those people who don't know what that means.
Massive multiplayer online role-playing game. And so, over the years, though, they've done a really good job of keeping this thing growing. Because one of the interesting things
there's
about
a movie
World
now?
Of Warcraft, there is a movie now, but one of the interesting things about it is that their subscriber base doesn't really grow. They've essentially kind of maxed out and tapped out, and these are the people who are going to play this game. Because the game's been around for, I mean,
forever.
Genuinely
so
10
like,
years.
There's no new
years.
There's no new subscribers, but
you don't get
the
new
older
players.
People die, and then the young kids start playing. So just it's flat. No. It's plateaued.
It's plateaued.
Their kids play it. They
yeah,
teach them their kids.
They hand it to their kids.
But also, before you get there, I've met people who play this game, and it's a wide variety
of age. It is a wide
age,
birth of people.
Anybody and everybody play it.
Really?
I remember I worked at Jason's Deli while I was still in school, and I worked with this kid. His name was Ricky.
Release date, November 23rd, 2004.
12 years.
12 years.
Wow.
So Ricky was a huge stoner.
Oh, Ricky, you're so fun. You're so fun. You blah blah blah. Hey, Ricky.
Maybe I should have used his real name. Hey, Ricky. It doesn't matter. People don't know. But so Ricky, I mean, shout out. What up, man? It's been like 10 years.
What up, bro? But thanks for that dank weed back today, bro.
Yeah, man. So when people would come in and order, like, people would kind of laugh sometimes when they would order from Ricky because he was really nice, really helpful.
Yeah.
But a complete stoner.
Yeah.
He had the whole like. Oh man, that sounds delicious! Like he'd be like, like that was him.
Oh yeah, dude, that's a good choice, sandwich. Man.
Oh, and the avocado on it.
Oh man, you gonna sub good, the ciabatta man. For the onion bun? That sounds terrific. By the way, onion bun toasted at Jason's Deli. Just about any sandwich you get on the onion bun toasted is phenomenal. That's just my
right,
favorite
fact
bread
of
toasted.
Life. But onion bun toasted.
Onion bun toasted. If you're ever at Jason's Deli, do that. Yeah, he was just a really nice guy, but he was totally the typical stoner. And so one day we're sitting there, and apparently a new expansion had just been released for World of Warcraft. And he was, like, really stressed out. And I was like, Ricky, what's going on, man? Like, you're throwing stuff around? Like, you're way out of your comfort zone here. What's up, man? And he's like, man. All right, look, man. He's like, look, they released the new expansion, right? And you didn't even explain what for. And I'm looking at him. I was like, I don't know what you're talking about. And he goes, World of Warcraft, man. Wow.
Like you were just supposed to know.
Right. Yeah. He goes, wow, man. Wow. And yeah. I was like, oh, okay, okay. So they released the new one. He goes, man. And all of a sudden, you know, they always level stuff off. And all of a sudden, my guy's like, just weak. My guy's just weak. I was a paladin. Now I'm nobody.
And now I'm Ricky. Nothing.
And so basically what happens is when they do these expansions, they listen to player complaints and they check their internal math and coding. And they will, like, level things and adjust things. Like, oh, so-and-so was hitting too hard when equipped with this and that. And they'll taper that off a little bit to kind of to keep fairness at a peak efficiency, to be
okay,
super nerdy.
Fair enough.
So what will happen is you will see guys who, like, oh, I always only played this one type because I figured out that it's the best. And then the new expansion comes out, and it downgrades that a little bit and upgrades something else.
I used to be a paladin, and now I'm nothing.
Now I'm nothing.
That's a good t-shirt.
Yeah, like, that's a good t-shirt.
Like, Ricky
right there.
Was devastated, man.
That's good right there.
And I felt bad. When he said that, I was like, oh, dude, like...
That sucks.
Your life is over, man.
Right, and he was probably like a level 45, this is how long ago that was. Like, he was like, this is it for me. And, like, just the sadness on Stoner Ricky's
now
face
nothing.
Really ripped me apart for, like, a whole day. I remember leaving work that day. It was at the apartment before you and I lived together.
Okay.
At that apartment. I remember coming home that day and sitting down with the TV on, and just for like 5 minutes, I couldn't focus on anything because I felt really bad for Ricky and his You're paladins. Like, I was like, because he looked so broken about this.
I feel for you, man.
Yeah. Like
you ever played World of Warcraft?
I've watched someone play for about 15 minutes, and it's not for me.
You swipe left?
Yeah, it's not for me.
Nico, what about you?
I've never really enjoyed MMOs to begin with, so... Nah.
I don't mind MMOs. I just haven't found one that I like.
So here's what I don't like.
That makes sense?
Yeah. So here's what I don't like. So Skyrim is a great game. We all agree. We all love Skyrim. Do you ever play Skyrim?
I have not.
Okay. Yeah. So Nico and I can agree that we love Skyrim.
It's a good game.
But what's fun is when you show up to do your quests and your stories and your adventures, you're the only guy there. What's not fun on a massive multiplayer online role-playing game, when you show up to do it, so is 258,000 other people.
They're so all like, there at once.
Everyone's hanging out there, and there's always some jerk just running around, getting in between everybody, just running around having fun.
That would probably be you.
Right. It would be me if I wasn't, like, if I'm not the guy playing the story. So, like, it just drives you crazy because you're trying to have your adventure, and they're like, only you can save the town.
And then there's 12 other people.
And there's 9 people getting the exact same information, right? Like, you look to your left and your right.
What kind of
crap
is this?
Do you mean me?
I'll just follow that guy.
Are you talking to underscore David? Like, which one of us are you talking to right now?
Hey, guys,
now?
It's your boy. Underscore David here.
Yeah. Underscore David.
I used
David.
To be a paladin.
Are you talking, you talking to Jellyfish?
Yeah.
Sergeant Jellyfish.
Are you talking to blowhard 1328757700?
Are you talking to poop underscore fire?
Right. Hot fire.
Hot fire.
Super hot fire.
But so, like,
Taco
just,
Bell sauce
it's
fire.
It's stupid because you're sitting there and there's 800 people getting the exact... And so then when you run along, they literally are running right alongside of you, killing
you. You're
all doing the same thing.
Yeah, but that's always, like, the beginning. But then you get, like, cool stuff like raids. Or there's, like, literally 40 people who, like,
boring.
Or you're
get
like
together and take down
somebody
a huge...
in the game. And
ooh.
That's happened.
Oh, let's tell that story. Okay.
Oh, you're going to tell the story?
I'm going to tell this story.
Are you going to do it?
I'm going to do it.
You going to censor their names? Give them fake names. Let's call them Jack and Sally.
How do I do this?
Let's call them Jack, Sally, and Sue.
Okay. So, okay. So I had a buddy of mine who
named Jack.
did in fact play the World of Warcraft, Jack.
Horrible.
And he loved it. He was a WoW guy.
Probably still plays it, would you think?
Oh yeah, probably. He would hang out with us. Like, he wasn't that far into it. He's not one of those guys who's like
doesn't
every
do anything
entire
else.
Life.
Like, yeah.
He, is he the guy that says, "Hey man, take me home. I have to go do a raid. It only happens Saturday at 11 o'clock, and then I can come back out."
No, no.
That was my favorite story ever.
That was so. When he said that, I
think we told that story once already.
I think we told it while he was on air.
Like, yeah, yeah. He's like, "Hey, yeah. You have to go back to your house." Cause,
all right, we're gonna call him out. That was Matthew Mayhem.
Yeah,
that came out. All right, I think we told that story while he was on the air. I just listened to that show recently, and I think we made that comment.
We need to get him on here.
We do need to get him back on. Now we're in the studio, we got to get him out.
Talk a little video games.
Get out here, Matt.
I'll see if I can hook him up for next week.
There you go. But so what happened was, he's on there, he's playing the WoW. That's how he spends his free time when he's not hanging out with everybody and being cool.
Jack.
He's a cool guy, Jack. And randomly one day he's like, "Hey, man, I think I owed him like $20. He's like, "Hey, I really need you to give me that money because I'm driving to Michigan next week."
I know that story.
You're right, and I was like, "You're driving to Michigan." I was like, "What's in Michigan?" I was like, "Maybe I'll tag along." And he was like, "Yeah, no, I'm helping this girl move because I'm bringing her home." And I was like, "Now I need more information.
Please go into this.
I need a little bit more.
Please
there.
Go into this story."
So
Mark?
Jack met Jill on World of Warcraft. They hit it off. Jill was just breaking up with someone, or wanted to break up with him, but they lived together. Jack was driving to Michigan to pack up her stuff with her. Bring her to Texas with him.
You have to tell, how long did they know each other on WoW?
I don't even think it was much.
I'm like, wow.
Yeah, it was like a few weeks.
Hey, Nico,
if I
find that
correctly.
Beck song, WoW.
Beck.
Okay, yeah. It was like a few weeks, if I remember correctly. And so he drives up to Michigan.
Drives
picks
up to Michigan.
Her up, packs her stuff up, brings her all the way back to Houston. They have together still to this day.
Now
it's
they have
been
a kid.
Many years. They have a kid together.
They have a kid named WoW.
That's true. They're very happy.
Yeah, the first time I met him, I said, "All right, what's that story?" Because
yeah.
They don't go together. At
no,
all.
They really don't. They're visually very different folk.
Very, very different.
And it's funny. It's just, they're like, yeah.
Cool people, though.
Yeah,
cool,
really nice.
Cool peeps. Just
their baby is gooey at all times. Gooey. Their baby is gooey.
But people say the same thing. When they see me and you, they're like, "Okay, tell me that story." Because
right.
Those two don't go together.
Right.
What did he do? How much money does he have? And I have none.
And I have none. So
I don't know what happens.
Their third question is, where is her seeing eye dog?
Yeah, exactly. Where's her service dog?
Right.
Did you know you can adopt retired service dogs?
You know what's to me ironic about that?
What?
Is now they need help.
Yeah, I know, right?
They're
Corey.
See, that's irony.
Aww,
hey, so have you ever skipped school or stayed home from work literally to play a video game when it first came out?
Yes.
Which one?
GTA.
GTA 3.
Me too. That's the
senior
only
year of high school.
Senior year. That's the only game I've ever missed time because I was gonna stay home and play it.
No, I also.
That's the only one. Grand Theft Auto 3.
Fabled.
Just
Fable. When Fable came out, I didn't even have an Xbox. When Fable came out, I took off 3 days in a row from Domino's Pizza. I borrowed my buddy's Xbox, and me and our buddy Officer Langston. Me and Officer Langston literally did not sleep for 50 straight hours.
I can't imagine Henry playing Fables.
And he and I. So okay, so Henry's the coolest dude to play video games with ever. Henry is so much fun to play video games with because he's chill. He'll just sit there and like he'll sometimes be like. Do that. And you're like, "Oh, yeah, okay, all right." So he would sometimes suggest.
He's so, like, suave about
right,
it.
Right, he's
like,
so calm.
Is he not playing, just watching you?
So he's, like, he's the alternate pilot in all scenarios. So, like, he hangs out, he watches, and, like, I, like, would tap out. Because you, hour 30.
So was he not holding the controller?
No, not for the first 30 hours. He's hanging out, watching me play, and helping me, and, like, "Hey, we should go do this. Hey, let's go do that."
Oh,
so then
okay.
It's, like, hour 30.
She's my wingman.
And, like, all of a sudden, like, I can't focus anymore. Like, I'm, like.
You
I was,
just
like,
lose connection to
yeah,
him.
Like,
you can't see, like, you're blind.
Yeah, you start
the,
to kind of. I was, like, "I think I just killed a town guard." He's, like, "Yeah, that was, like, the third one." And
oh,
I was, like,
no.
Oh. I was, like,
oh, no.
I was, like,
take
all
the
right.
Reins. Take the reins.
Here you go, buddy. So, like, I would watch him play and, like, doze off and watch him play and doze off. We literally played 50 straight hours on this Xbox, the first Fable, which was you choose the alignment of your character. It was the first game like this where your actions in the game would award you good or evil points.
Okay.
And your character would literally evolve on screen, and his relationships with characters in the game would change based on whether or not he was evil or good. If you're evil, when you walk into a town, the guards are all on high alert. Children run away. The women would literally close shops and lock doors. If you're good, when you walk in, people like hand you money and thank you for killing the monsters and stuff. Like, it was a really interesting game, and also, like, you would grow horns or you would get like a holy aura around you.
Did
like,
you beat it?
We did everything you could possibly do in this game in 3 days. We literally just dominated.
I never would have beaten the Godfather video game
had it not been for Mommy Savage.
Oh, I loved watching that because it was like a story. It was like telling a story the whole time. Yeah,
it was
and
on
I'm
the
like,
Xbox 360.
I gotta know what happens next.
And so like I'd be playing, she would tell me what to do when I'd get tired. And I remember like, hey, do you want to play? No, I just want to watch. This is great. You just keep going. Like, okay. And then I would get tired. I'm like, okay, I'm gonna go. It's like, no, you can't. You're so close to beating this stage. Keep going.
We have to know what happens.
It's like, I'm not throwing in the towel on you yet. You can do it.
You talk like a life coach.
You have to burn down the bank first.
That was the necessary portion of that story.
Yeah, it was.
It really was.
And I was like, I'm going to play wrestling. And she was like, no, that's okay. I'll go to bed now.
I'll see you later. In my dorm, the WWE SmackDown had just come out on the PlayStation 2.
Yeah, it was 2 back then.
And we actually went to Toys R Us and bought a little $13 World Heavyweight title. Yeah. And the belt holder
was
on...
They're not $13 anymore, by the way. They're very
not.
Expensive.
The real ones are expensive.
The belt holders were obligated to defend their title at any non-class challenge time.
So it was like the hardcore title
like
at any point in time?
Any point
Remember
in time.
That with
was
the hardcore
this in
title?
Alabama?
This was in... So yeah. So sometimes like people would walk through the door of the dorm and someone would be like, I challenge you! He's like, oh, come on, man! And he's like, no! And so like, you had to...
Stop your homework. Let's go.
You had... If they did not have class at that instant, if it wasn't class related, that's the only thing we agreed to. You had to defend the title if it wasn't class related.
My freshman year, we had a huge Madden league going on. So there was... Like 8 of us in one
That's
league.
That's the Michael Vick Madden, because we also played that Madden also.
Yeah, and it would stink because you'd get to like season 3, and you could like relocate a team.
Yeah.
But if you relocated a team by season 4, it just crapped out.
Yeah.
You had to start over.
Everyone
so we probably started over.
Relocate a
team.
Oh, yeah.
Mexico City or Las Vegas, every time.
Every time.
But,
Albuquerque, for some reason.
So we had to like start over like 4 times because it's like, stop relocating.
There was also
no one would listen.
The Madden before that one. No. The Madden with Eddie George on it.
Yeah.
If you had too many created characters, it would crap out in the middle of the season. So, like, all of my homies on the street, we made ourselves in the game. We were sitting there playing. There's, like, 8 of us. And, by, like, game 7, it's like, brr, brr, brr.
Which Madden
just
was
stopped
it
existing.
That y'all were playing a couple years ago, and he kept crapping out? Like, you were doing well, but...
Oh, he was never doing well.
Oh, yeah, that was a.
But I thought 15? His kept messing up too because you kept relocating him.
No, he just.
No, that was a.
He just kept losing.
Yeah, I just kept.
Oh, you were
just. Geno Smith
that was just the end of
is
him.
The greatest quarterback
well, that was
of all time.
Tennessee had. They were just like the worst team ever that year. That
I took the Giants.
Yeah, I took the Titans.
And I traded for Geno Smith. And between him and Odell Beckham Jr., we were the greatest tandem
the greatest
in the world.
Team of all time.
Yeah.
The greatest tandem in the world.
Joey did develop
Geno Smith, 99 overall. So, Alex P. Middleton, if you're listening, I took the Giants to the Super Bowl 4 years in a row.
That's true.
Take that.
Boom.
Bada boom.
Rose guys in the room.
Hi-yo.
God.
You know what's funny is, like, we don't even plan it. No. When I say it, he knows to go with it.
It's the call.
It's the call of the wild.
I hate you, too.
You love us. That's why you do the show with us.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, it's true. You couldn't do it without us.
You couldn't do it without us.
You couldn't do it without us.
He needs us.
So we got a pretty awesome weekly top 3 coming up here in the next segment.
That's a myth.
No, it's not.
No, we're not even going to do a weekly top 3.
Yeah, we're doing a weekly top 3.
It's a weekly top 7.
Oh.
So usually we do some character-driven or something like that matter. This week, the weekly top 3 is our top 3 favorite plot twists.
Wow.
This is Beck. Wow. Just let this roll for a sec.
Oh, man. I don't think I've heard of this.
My favorite line is when he goes, and the Lamborghini Shih Tzu. Like, what the heck does that even mean?
He's like, let me find
what
something
that
mean? Rhyme.
It's a really furry dog.
With its top down?
Yeah,
it's
probably.
It goes fast. Nerd Thug Radio.
Yeah, Nerd Thug Radio indeed.
Hey, you listening to the podcast? What do you think so far? We really like doing it. Hit us up on Facebook.com/NerdThugRadio with your thoughts. Keep in mind, we're live every Monday from 1 to 3. Check us out on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. We're everywhere. Nerd Thug Radio, talking nerdy to you.
Oh my God, it's Jason Bourne.
Jesus Christ,
it's Jason.
Just kidding. It's the Captain Joey Savage sitting here with
Cory DLG.
And behind the ones and the twos...
Your boy Nico DLG here.
And we've got special guest, the mom of Savages, Mommy Savage.
Hi.
AKA Allison Savage.
Hola.
Whoop whoop.
Whoop whoop. We are Nerd Thug Radio.
We are on irlonestar.com.
True.
Very, very, very soon to be Conroe's FM 104.5, 106.1.
Check right now.
Sister stations.
Check right now.
Check right now.
Check us out on nerdthugradio.com.
Oh, also check that right now.
Oh, yeah.
Log in right now.
Uh-huh.
Check
and
it.
The Facebook.
Log in. Check it.
And the Book of Faces, /nerdthugradio. You can find us on any social media site.
That was like my internet login noise.
With the hashtag nerdthugradio. Or the hashtag.
No. Talking nerdy to you.
Thank you, Nico DLG. While these two kids over here fight, me and Nico will continue the show.
Yeah, whatever. Do your stupid show.
Do your stupid show, guys.
We don't care. We don't care.
He started it.
We don't care.
He started it.
All right. Segment number three of the show today. And this is where we do our weekly top three.
Woo. Man, I really thought you were going to do it. I'm so excited for it. I was like, Nico,
just go, Nico.
Jumping on it. All right.
Let's try this again.
Okay. All right.
This is segment three of the show where we do our weekly top three.
Weekly top three.
All right, that's it.
That was okay. All right, okay. All right.
You
want
to try it? You want to try it again, or
no?
Do one?
No, I'm happy. Okay. We'll let.
I appreciate it, guys.
We'll let Junior take the lead.
So we tasked Nico with coming up with the topic for the weekly top three this week. So Nico, what's the weekly top three? I've already mentioned it once, but
plot twist. It's a plot twist.
And where did you come up with this idea?
I was watching videos on M. Night Shyamalan.
Very nice. Very nice.
What a twist!
What a twist! In typical Nerd Thug fashion, we let the worst go first. Nico, you're number three.
My number three is the ending of Mass Effect 3 being terrible. No, I'm kidding. It's Rick and Morty, the Evil Morty episode. So in this episode of Rick and Morty,
so we're in the car. Hold on, we're in the car.
All right,
and I say, Nico, any of your top three? He's like, yeah, I've got them all. I was like, okay. Does one of them include Rick and Morty? He's like, yep, exactly. I think the last five episodes now.
It's just Rick and
Morty.
Rick
and Morty have made it into the top three of Nico DLG.
I just love it. It's so great.
All right, so go ahead, hit us with it.
So in this episode, one Rick has been going into other dimensions, killing all the other Ricks and stealing their Mortys.
Where's the plot twist?
The plot twist comes at the end of the episode when they find out that the evil Rick was actually being controlled by an evil eye-patched Morty the entire time.
Oh, plot
and
twist.
And at the end of the episode, he removes his mind control device on the Rick and then crushes it and then walks into the crowd of Mortys being taken away so he could hide from the Ricks.
Plot twist at its finest.
Dun, dun.
Evil Morty.
Evil Morty strikes back. I used to be a paladin.
Like, I haven't seen
and
that.
Now I'm
like
nothing.
That.
Yeah.
Yeah. Poor Rick, man.
Let's go to DLG. You want to go your number three?
Yeah, I can do my number three here.
Go for it. Is it Rick and Morty?
It is not. Mine are more comic book related.
Okay, cool. Very
I
cool.
always love the comic book twist.
Twist.
It's a twist.
What a twist. So, this first one, it's really the only thing this particular writer has ever done that I've liked. Writer by the name of Chuck Austin.
Chuck Austin.
He's pretty much
Little brother.
If you look him up now, it's like the opposite of Stone Cold. He's like the most hated comic book writer in the history of Marvel and the history of X-Men.
But he's written comics and we haven't. So
this is true.
Props to you, Chucky.
This is true.
He's hated than the people that decided to make Captain America part of Hydra.
Hail
more
Hydra.
More hated.
Hail
than
Hydra.
This actually, it's kind of interesting now when you look back, like literally even in Wikipedia, which is like supposedly an encyclopedia, it doesn't pick sides. The tone of the Wikipedia articles of Chuck Austin stories is brutal.
It's because anybody can go in there and change it.
Right, but like even in there, they're like, and for reason, he made this happen, and this now canon.
We
no
need a
Nerd Thug
Radio Wikipedia page.
We do. Someone should do that.
Someone
so where's
the
plot twist come
from? So the twist is,
what is the
when
twist?
He picked up from Grant Morrison's run of New X-Men.
Okay.
Grant Morrison done this crazy run. The mutants were going to inhabit the Earth. Humans are dying off. They have only a few generations left. This is all pre-House of M, obviously. And they find this mutant, Zorn. Grant Morrison loved making these really complicated, crazy characters.
Okay.
Zorn had a star for a brain, and these monks had built him a helmet to contain it. So he had all these weird, kind of cool, kind of gravity sort of powers. But essentially, he was just this really laid-back Buddhist dude. The twist is, Chuck Austin, for whatever reason, reveals that it's secretly Magneto in hiding. Zorn had even healed Xavier, and Xavier had been walking around for like the last 40 issues. Then they revealed, no, Magneto did that simply to torment Xavier when he took the metal out of his spine again that he had used to fake a healing.
That's like a horrible twist.
It was interesting.
That's a rough twist.
A very rough, lame twist.
It was interesting at the time because Magneto had actually been off the radar for a few years.
Brought him back.
And the fans had started to be
back to reality.
Like, fans always kind of do that in cycles. We're like, okay, it's been a while.
Where's Magneto?
Where is he at, dude?
Where's the Wolverine coming back?
Turns out Magneto had been on the X-Men for
as
like
Zorn,
2 years.
The whole
as
time.
Zorn.
Well, awkward.
Yeah, so that's my number three.
Mommy Savage, you want to contribute to this conversation?
I only have one.
She's got one. Do you want to save it till the end or do you want to go now?
I don't care. What do you want me to do?
Go now.
All right, seven.
Seven.
Which, y'all are fighting is not a plot twist, but it is a definite plot twist.
Because the internet said so.
That's true.
So which plot twist?
The internet agreed with me.
Which plot twist are you talking about?
At the very end, Kevin Spacey drives him out into the desert to tell him that he, you know, that they're going to find the last two bodies. And while they're out there, Brad Pitt, who's, you know, the detective, gets delivered a box. And
what's in the box, man?
What's in the box, man?
What's in the box?
I like Brad Pitt.
He does nail it more often than not.
And so in the box is his wife's head. So that's the
sixth
envy, the sixth sin.
The sixth sin.
Which was envy. And then, which ticks Brad Pitt off, and then he shoots Kevin Spacey, and that's the seventh sin.
Wrath.
Correct. Yeah. So
that's
yeah.
clever.
It is a
plot twist. The conversation we had before coming on the air about this scene, to me, this isn't a plot twist. This is a thrill. It's not really a plot twist because the
title
of the movie.
You're not expecting it.
But the title.
But is it the plot twist to get you to the seventh sin?
No, because a plot twist to me would be if Morgan Freeman had been the killer all along. That would have been a plot twist. To have the man who says he's the killer take you to the place where you're going to find two more bodies. But then he tricks you into creating the two bodies there. That's not a twist. That was his plan. Like,
but
to
it
me,
you
the
don't
plot twisted
it.
On him when Brad Pitt killed him to do the seventh
yeah,
sin.
No, that was exactly what Kevin Spacey wanted.
Yeah,
he wanted
exactly.
To die?
But you don't
yes.
know that he wanted that. You don't know that he wanted
right,
that.
But that's what makes it a thrill, I think, more than a... I don't think it's a plot
but
twist.
But the internet said it was a twist,
right,
bro.
And the internet did yeah. say it was a twist. I can't
the internet
that.
Doesn't lie, bro.
Yeah, duh. You've been on Tinder.
You mean
you
someone
know
would go onto the internet and post lies?
I know.
No, nonsense. No, no. I mean, I guess I can't argue the internet. It is the home of all truths.
Yeah.
It is created by Al Gore.
Yep.
Thank you, Al Gore.
Thank you, bro.
Thank
we
you.
Appreciate it.
but I just...
Mad props, Al Gore.
Mad props.
Mad props. Thank you for all that porn, Al Gore. That's
you can't
what we should
tell
really
me.
Do. We should write Al Gore letters thanking him for how much pornography we've all seen.
Let's
I
do
used
it.
To be a paladin.
Hashtag
now I'm nothing.
Now
radio.
I'm nothing. Yeah, hashtag Nerdthug Radio. Write your letters to Al Gore. Put hashtag Nerdthug
just tweet
radio.
It.
When you're watching,
start tweeting it to Al Gore and just hashtag
tweet
Nerdthug
at
Radio.
Al Gore. Yeah. Thank you for the thousands of countless hours of girl-on-girl action. Thank you.
Al Gore.
It's a plot twist because did you expect it?
But that's not... But that means every time the shark in Jaws ate a person, it's a plot twist. It's a thrill. It's not a plot twist. It's a thrill. It was an unexpected moment. I agree completely. But it wasn't...
There's no right or wrong answers. It's our top three.
Yeah. Bro.
I'm always right.
You're always wrong. Remember when we first started doing the top three, we'd always like argue and
yeah.
like discredit each
yeah.
other. No, no, that can't be it because this.
That's not your top three.
Yeah. I don't consider the ending. I love the movie. I love that you like the movie.
It's amazing.
I don't consider the ending a plot twist. I consider it a thrill.
Definitely a plot twist.
All right, Joey, that's your number three.
My numero tres, the first plot twist I can ever remember seeing ever.
All right.
The movie Sixth Sense.
Ooh.
I think when the movie came out, we were
that's
probably...
That's so cliche. Chameleon.
But we were in, like, what, sixth grade when that came out, maybe?
Yeah.
And I saw it in the theaters, and it just plot twisted, and it mind screwed me.
Right.
And I was like, this is not supposed to happen. This is what happens in movies.
And there's really, like, a minor twist in the middle, and then the big twist at the
I
end.
Right.
And the minor twist in the middle is that at the beginning, you don't really believe the kid. And that's
right.
kind of the what it feels like the mystery of the movie is going to be is the kid making this up or not? Then about midway through the movie, Bruce Willis realizes that ghosts are real. And then obviously
crap.
The big twist at the end, spoiler alert, Bruce
spoiler
Willis
alert.
Is dead
spoiler.
Nearly
spoiler.
The entire movie.
But being in sixth grade, seeing that plot twist, it's very iconic. You can say that it's, you know, whatever.
It's been
it's
made
first,
fun of so much, but it is probably...
It's the first one I ever saw, and I was, what, 12 years old?
It's probably
it
the,
is, and
he
never lived up to that ever again.
Who? Shalalam
yeah,
or the little kid?
Shamalamalama
ding dong.
Well, we talked about this before. I think my theory is that after, like, Hollywood wants
it.
You to, yeah, he got typecasted as the plot twist director. And Hollywood's really big on sequels and repeating concepts. Blair Witch is coming out again. So's The Ring.
Yeah,
you know,
it's Rings and like the Blair Witch 2.
Right.
It's like
yeah.
the Blair Witch Ring.
Recycle
The Ring and the
and
Blair
so
Witch.
And so Hollywood said, "Hey, you made a really good plot twist movie. Give us three more plot twist movies."
But just seeing that in the sixth grade, it like screwed my mind.
I love Signs, though. Signs was a great
movie. I was not used to
yeah,
seeing movies
yeah,
like that.
It was okay.
Signs
it
is a great, like...
It
that's because Mel Gibson's
movie,
in it.
But it wasn't as good as Sixth Sense. I mean, you can't...
Signs was a
I like
was
the,
a better...
That was,
I mean, I like
such
The Village.
A shock effect.
Right, it wasn't...
I like The Village.
They're all good movies, but nothing lives up to that effect of Sixth Sense.
But they're not all good movies. The fairy tale movie?
No. Not all of his movies are good. All
right, my number two is M. Night Shyamalan's Career.
Look at Nico just
what a twist.
Nico's just pushing us right along here.
Yeah.
All right, Nico, what's your number two, bud?
My number two actually is M. Night Shyamalan's. No, it's M. Night Shyamalan's Career, from being one of the most critically acclaimed actors. He's going to be like the next.
Is Nico going to start going like meta with his top threes? I'm okay with this.
This is where I'm going with this. He started
the plot
out so
twist
strong.
That he wasn't good?
The plot twist that he actually was not a very good director after smash hits like Sixth Sense and then after that Unbreakable, which both have huge followings.
Correct. Unbreakable was a great movie.
See, I didn't like that movie.
Well, some people don't.
It's got a
very cult
hate.
Following.
Well, it's really an interesting movie. To me, Unbreakable is a really interesting movie because I think it's a brave movie to make off
and
of
it's
Six
Breakable.
Six.
Yeah, I might need to go watch it again because I was young.
It's really slow. It's a hard watch because it's very slow. There's a lot of really tense scenes that really don't ever, nothing ever
happens,
but they build tension well in the scenes. Yeah. And I think it's a really, if you watch it now and think about, I like to do things in vacuums. I like to only watch this movie as this movie and not think about anything else about it.
Yeah.
And I don't
think
about...
That's why I enjoy most of the comic book movies.
Right. And that's... Yeah. And like, I don't think about Tom Cruise jumping on a couch when I watch Mission Impossible. I just want to watch Mission Impossible.
I can't think of
Mission Impossible
without Tom Cruise jumping
on a
couch.
I don't see
Matt Damon as Jason Bourne when I'm watching...
Oh, my God.
It's
Jason Bourne.
Right.
Also, he was in The Happening. No, also, a very bad movie by M. Night Shyamalan.
Right. Yeah. But if you watch Unbreakable and you think about it in the context of M. Night Shyamalan, where The Sixth Sense had just happened... The next thing he does is Unbreakable. It's a really great choice and really a brave pick because it's slow. It develops.
It was very slow.
It's sort of like a character building story.
Long.
And then it ends at the beginning of a story. It doesn't tell you the story you want. It tells you the story he wants to tell, and then he's done. He doesn't tell you the story of Bruce Willis, a superhero. It tells you the story of how does Bruce Willis realize he's a superhero. Mm-hmm. And then it ends. And to me, that's a really brave choice because it almost... It's like... Right before the era of sequels, and you almost knew he was never going to come back and do anything with it. It was just kind of a really interesting choice, and then the rest of his career after that is just
plot twisted downhill.
Mixed bag, being terrible. Also, the Last Airbender was the saddest movie in existence.
Well, yeah, I mean,
I think that's why you hate him. You take it personal.
Yeah, after
I
that,
take
though,
personal.
He did Signs, which you liked.
I
he
love
did
Signs.
The Village, which I enjoyed. And then,
do you think that like he got done with some of those movies and like, man, this turned out terrible?
I think probably the Paul Giamatti one he hates.
Yeah,
because that
was
pretty bad.
Which one was that?
Well,
that's the Sideways? No,
that's the one with the
they're in a swimming pool.
The
preview?
Swimming pool connects to like a fantasy world.
Yeah,
nope,
and then like there's
that.
A
so,
legend.
Like, fake Narnia.
Nope, swipe left.
Yeah, it's really weird, man.
It's
okay.
The Shalamalam.
You don't have to explain anything.
It's
no,
Shalamalam.
I
kind
of want to, lost me. Because it's so silly.
Night, Lion, Witch, in the Wardrobe.
Remember? It's that kind of. Remember, like,
didn't he cast himself as like the great artist?
No, no,
that was too ahead of his time.
Yeah. So in it, the Little Mermaid can tell the future.
Oh,
and the Little Mermaid tells a bunch of timelines, and
no, I want to watch this movie.
Swipe left,
and like, then I think one of them was like he kills a critic or something like that. Like the critic,
no, a critic kills him.
Oh yeah,
so he's gonna write this book.
We should Mystery Science Theater this movie.
Yeah, so M. Night Shyamalan was apparently already in the middle of writing the book. His character in the movie, he's already in the middle of writing the book. The book has something really important to it that's gonna change the ideas of the world. However, he won't live to see the changes. His children though will. That was what the mermaid tells him. So he knows he's writing this book. It's not going to be a big deal. He is going to get married and have kids. He will be murdered by a critic, by someone who disagrees with the philosophies of the book or something like that. And then the kid will like...
Why did this movie not do well?
This sounds
amazing.
Because it was so... The Guardians and the Wolves and the guy who works
like
out half his body. Like,
sounds like he was on an acid trip.
Yeah, it sounds like a mixture between like Hitchhiker's Guide and that Mr...
The last movie that Heath Ledger did.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
That movie was
terrible.
Wonder Emporium.
I like that movie.
So it sort of kind of just combines a lot of
with Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory.
Myth and like,
R.I.P. Gene Wilder.
Yeah.
Oh,
that's true.
Awesome.
We did lose Gene Wilder this week.
No, that's really
amazing.
Sad.
He was
a world.
He was definitely
of
ahead
pure
of his
imagination.
Time.
I don't even think he was ahead of his time. I think he was just unique.
I read such a cool article today that said that. He only agreed to do the Willy Wonka movie if he went in and he was like, all right, I agree to do this movie if I can create the first scene. He was the one that came up with he's going to come out walking on a cane. The cane was going to get stuck and he was going to do a tumble. And it kind of creates the whole essence of, is he lying or is he telling the truth the whole time?
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah,
because that's one of my favorite movies of all time.
And that's the most iconic scenes.
Yeah.
And I love that scene. He was the one that came up with it.
Huh.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
But Gene Wilder was a true artist. Did a lot of just, he was in that great comedy era with, oh my God.
Richard Pryor.
But no, I'm talking the director, the one who does the History of the World.
No idea.
Yeah.
Oh, man. The guy who actually, please look this
up. Mel Brooks?
Mel Brooks.
Oh, I love Mel Brooks.
So Mel Brooks is kind of the area.
Captain Joey Savage for the save. Yeah, bring in the lefty.
I couldn't believe that I totally spaced Spaceballs.
didn't Kevin Spacey there.
Blazing Saddles.
Holy Grail, that's right? Richard Pryor.
That's Monty Python.
Yeah. Richard Pryor and Gene Wilder, though, are part of that Mel Brooks kind of cast of actors that he used over and over and over again.
Yeah.
And Gene Wilder.
Did you do Robin Hood, Men in Tights? Is that him?
No.
Or was that Monty Python too?
No, that wasn't Monty Python.
The comedy.
You know?
That was hilarious.
It has Cary Elwes in it.
Wasn't Dave Chappelle in there?
Yeah, I think he's the monk.
No, he's
Little John.
He wears a Robin Hood suit. I thought at one point.
Yeah, he's one of the
What a great movie.
Yeah, Merry Men.
Anyways, we go off on the left field.
That was way off, guys.
Let's bring it back to
number
two. Top three.
Okay, so my number two, this is a completely different one. Ultimate Spider-Man. The Return of Dr. Octopus, Peter Parker's...
I like how you say octopus.
He did the producers.
Yes.
I like how you say octopus.
Octopus. So...
Octopus.
Young Peter Parker is gloating over the Return of Dr. Octopus because S.H.I.E.L.D. has destroyed Dr. Octopus's arms. So what now, fool?
So what does he have?
You ready for the big plot twist?
Yep.
Dr. Octopus controls metal. Boom!
Oh, no.
So he just rips off...
So he just builds four new tentacles just out of all the debris laying around.
Aha!
He did do
Robin Hood, Men in Tights.
Mel Brooks?
Thank you.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
1993.
I was
going to
say, it was so recent that I didn't think that was something he...
He also did... He was also in Look Who's Talking, too. That's pretty awesome. And the Muppet movie.
We totally just...
Do love the Muppets.
You really did, yeah.
You're number two.
That's all right. No, so Dr. Octopus can control metal in the Ultimate Universe.
That's so weird.
But it was such
they
a
did
random,
so many goofy things in
but
the
it was
Ultimate
so
Universe.
Fun because, like, Peter Parker was like, oh, yeah, I got him beat this time. No arms. It's just a fat scientist with four limbs. Then he makes four more with metal that he controls.
And then he's like, oh.
Yeah.
And done.
And done. But, yeah, it was a really cool plot twist at the time because there's, like, two issues left in the arc. You know something else is still about to come up. But you really, Peter Parker's on a high. You really feel like you've won. You're excited. And then Dr. Octopus controls metal.
It's all over.
Is it called Dr. Magneto Octopus? Magneto Octopus mashup?
Do you really want me to answer that?
Yes, I do.
No.
Please answer
it. It was not called
it wasn't. It wasn't an amalgam.
Yeah.
Oh, man. That would have been great. Okay, so my number two?
No.
Go for it.
Go ahead.
My number two is pretty iconic as well. It wasn't a major plot twist to us because this movie was around before we were even born.
Okay.
But Star Wars, whenever it's revealed.
Oh, you know, I thought about
space
this.
Space Conflict?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's a pretty good one.
Yeah, Space Conflict is a great plot twist. No, but when it's revealed that Vader is...
I am your father.
You know, how iconic is that? I am your father. No one saw it coming.
No one saw it coming then. Well, and, except that they say that what...
Like Vader.
Darth Vader stands for
like Dark
Father or something in German.
Oh, does Vader
come?
Oh,
Vader.
But still, no one saw that coming.
The Germans saw it coming.
Yeah.
The Germans.
The one thing
like,
they got
it,
right.
Yes.
Yeah, but it was such a huge plot twist to the story. You find out that he's been fighting his father the whole time. And
can I tell you a fun little factoid about that scene?
You sure can, my friend.
So in that scene, the guy playing Darth Vader obviously is not James Earl Jones.
And they've never met either.
They've never been in the same room. They've never met. So James Earl Jones isn't on set. So George Lucas is just telling different things to the guy to say. Not he knows, but no one else yet knows the twist.
Okay, very cool.
So Luke Skywalker, Mark Hamill, is just having to react to each of these different things. And there's various things that he said, like he was his father, he killed his father, he's a robot built out of his father. Like they were just having fun with it, doing some different sci-fi things.
Mm-hmm.
But they never knew, they, while filming, didn't know what the twist was going to be either.
That is so awesome.
That is cool.
So it's a genuine
very cool
reaction.
When you keep them out of the loop.
What movie did we see that was just like that recently, where they were keeping the... Or Lost, when they talk about Lost.
Yeah.
People only received the scenes they were in like a week before.
Or Walking
Dead.
The same way. No one really knows when they're going to get hacked off.
Yeah.
And I think we talked about, what's his name?
You get the high sign from the producer.
Merle. Yeah.
Yeah, he bought a house
in
there
Atlanta,
like 2 weeks later.
He got killed in the show.
He's killed off.
But he's made a, He's made it. It's worked out for him because he plays Yondu. And a lot of Marvel Disney stuff is filmed in Atlanta anyway. So, yeah,
so he just
he's been okay. He's so been right. Let's jump, Nico.
My number
numero uno.
My number one is also Star Wars related, but it's Star Wars video game universe. So I don't know if either of you guys have played The Old Republic.
Nope.
Knights of the Old Republic was a great RPG.
Was it?
And,
yes. Is it an MMO?
No. Just an RPG on the Xbox.
Back and forth.
What are you doing?
I don't know.
I'm just dipping bouncing back in right here.
Now. I'm standing while I'm doing this segment, so I'm just getting the juices flowing.
Okay. Yeah, okay. So in this game, you always hear about this the Darth Sith Lord, Revan, and he's one of the most powerful Jedi that have ever existed, and he was kind of a neutral Jedi. He never really went to one side or the other, and you go through this game hearing about him, talking about how powerful he was, and as soon as you get to the very end, you regain all your memories back, and then it's Revan takes his mask off, and it was you the entire game. You were Darth Revan. You were this great Jedi.
But neither good nor bad. Can you do that as a Jedi?
I don't know. He was supposed to be kind of like this, like really like just incredibly strong. Where he
like an anti-hero Jedi?
Yeah, kind of. He was
bend
he
the
was,
rules a bit.
He was
a,
he was
so
technically
like young
a Sith
Anakin
Lord, but he
Skywalker?
Did not care. Like there was a character named Darth Malak who just used to like talk back a lot, and then one time Revan was just like just be quiet, and he chopped his jaw off.
Whoa, that's
impolite.
Yeah,
impolite.
So he chops his jaw off, and you fight him for the rest of the game. He's got this big metal jaw over his mouth.
that's kind of cool.
Yeah,
do they call him like Iron Jaw from that point forward.
No,
Lock Jaw.
he's still Darth Malak, and there was a secret ending where you can just dance the night away.
Dance the night away.
We would dance the night. I don't know the song. I know the words, but I don't know the song.
I just started going.
So
with
yeah,
it.
That was yeah. That's my number one video game. All check right. it out. Knights of the Republic.
DL Jizzle okay. of the Cory variety. You're numero uno.
Oh, I have one more.
Oh God. Okay.
Oh man. Oh.
You want to jump in here?
Yeah. Go ahead.
I do. Okay. So
she
anybody
really
that knows me knows that I love
Holes.
Shia LaBeouf and Leonardo DiCaprio. I've loved Leonardo DiCaprio since I was in like third grade.
Yeah. Okay.
So anyway, Shutter Island. Have y'all ever seen
that?
It?
Was a good one. That's a good twist.
So
you know,
good.
I have something to say about that movie. From the previews. I called the movie.
The whole thing. I didn't watch the
movie. That's impressive. That's good.
Yeah. I just, there was something about, like, one of the lines in the preview is a throwaway, and it's like, who is number whatever.
So they gave it away.
Yeah. In that one, just that one line, I was like, oh, well, obviously he is, and then he's investigating.
It threw
himself.
Me off.
Yeah, but it's,
I mean, I didn't,
Martin,
she was watching it, and
Martin
I was.
Martin Scorsese,
yeah.
So it's like a big, big
deal. It was
deal.
A huge deal. It was a huge deal.
I was kind of watching it in the background while she was watching it, and it blew my mind. It was a good plot twist.
Yeah.
I
like
want to
the
say
Leo
buddy Henry was about to go watch it.
Oh,
and I just jokingly I told him, I was like, hey, it's going to be Leonardo DiCaprio is the killer and that he's investigating himself. And he probably is like scared of fire or something. And like I walked away and I get a text from him and he was like, did you effing see this movie before me?
You jerk.
And I was like, no, I just saw the previews. And he was like, you have no idea how right
so what
are.
Happens is
how about the two Henry references this show?
Yeah, shout out Officer Langston.
Oh. Nerd Thug Radio. Salute you. All right, go ahead. What were you saying?
No, so the whole movie, you know, he's searching around this island trying to find this woman that's escaped from this asylum that killed her three kids. And anyway, it was this elaborate game to get him to admit that he killed his kids.
In a house
and his
fire,
wife.
Right?
Ugh. No, he drowned him.
Oh, he drowned him?
He drowned him.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
I can't stand people like that.
Well, you know what?
I hate reading the Yahoo front page.
There's clearly something wrong with these people. Like, I don't know. I'm very intrigued by, like, when in mental illness, when is it their fault and when is it not? And how do you decide that when you're literally talking about somebody who, like, sees something wholly not there but still interacts with it? Like, it's just a weird thing to me.
But
it's
is it one awkward. Of those things that, like, you kind of know the whole time that these people are mentally ill? Or is there are there actually mental illnesses out there where someone just snaps and, like,
probably
been normal their whole lives and then they snap? And
it's got to be.
So that's where I – there's a gray area for
that's
me.
That's fair.
Because if you know they were crazy the whole time – just don't let them have kids. You know what I'm saying?
Right,
You knew they were crazy. You have documentation that they were crazy. Don't let them reproduce. But then there are these people that
seem normal
see,
and then
seem
just snap.
So normal.
Right.
Well, you see it a lot, like some of these people in recent news doing these mass killings. Like they seem, not recent, but there's someone that just, they seem normal. And then all of a sudden it's just like, boom, he's never been in trouble with the law. Some have, but there's those ones that haven't been in trouble with the law, have no real record. And then they just go off the
loop.
But
then there are the crazy ones that like go shoot up schools and you're like, they talk to interview people. Oh, yeah, we knew he was kind of crazy. He was living with his mom, and she let him buy, like, 15 guns.
Yeah.
Well, okay.
There's definitely Well, but you know what? I'm going to take the other side of this. Just as crazy to me are the deniers of these events after they happen.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Have you seen that? That stuff, that really trips me
conspiracy
out.
Conspiracy theorists?
Like, yeah.
Sandy Hook never happened.
Oh, yeah, Sandy Hook never happened.
I saw this really great exchange. It was really powerful to me, where this mother of one of the children of Sandy Hook, like, was in one of those pages where she was like, are you kidding me? Like, blow, like she was livid about the fact that they were discussing how that she didn't lose anything. Also, I watched this document. I love those crime shows where, like, there's weird stuff that comes up. There was one where this man disappeared, and more than likely he was found and murdered, or more than likely he was murdered, but they don't know where he is. They don't know what's going on with him. They're investigating the possibility he ran away, though, because his car keys and wallet are missing, and they keep getting sightings of him in other places. And it just so happened.
Oh, where they went to Mexico and they saw him spotted in Mexico?
No. This one's a different one, but it just so happened to happen in the town of Sandy Hook around the same time as the shooting.
Oh, wow.
That he disappeared. I think he disappeared within like a month of the shooting. And so the conspiracy theorists were like, he's not really missing. He's part of the Sandy Hook thing. And like the family was in such turmoil because they were trying to find him. They're trying to investigate it. They're trying to work with the police.
Right.
But everywhere they turn, everything on the social media, they can't even get his face out there on the Facebook page because everyone, the Sandy Hook deniers are getting all over their page and like, taking it over and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So it was really interesting thing to watch because the family was like
spamming it the crap out of the page. Yeah.
And the police even had to come forward and be like, look, we don't think this has anything to do with the shooting at all, which definitely happened. We don't think this had anything to do with it. Please stop.
Bring it up.
Yeah.
So we're running out of time here on this segment. So Cory, real quick, you're number one.
I hope I'm not stealing yours. The Usual Suspects.
No, it's not mine.
Kaiser Soze.
That's a good one.
Kevin Spacey.
I remember watching that movie and when they like pieced it all together at the end and you start seeing he pulled stuff off of
the wall and told the greatest story ever.
Awesome. Yeah, that was like the number one on all the movie sites. When
I saw that movie, okay, I actually just caught it just randomly on TV one day, like with commercials and everything. Had never seen it before, never heard of it before. And I'm watching it and when he starts walking normal into the car, I was like, holy crap, I have to seek this out and watch every version of this movie. Like it blew me away. It's a great movie. Great twist.
My number one is Fight Club.
Okay.
Classic Fight Club.
Yeah, it's one of my probably top five favorite movies of all time. And I didn't see it when it came out. I was late coming to the party. It was probably my freshman or sophomore year in college when I finally saw it. But just finding out that Brad Pitt really doesn't exist and it's just
broke my heart.
The sleep deprived, you know, insomnia.
Brad Pitt's really not real.
Of Ed,
yeah, of Ed Norton. Just been making
it's crazy.
It's just, yeah, it was insane, and it blew my mind. And it was such Chuck Palahniuk is such a great writer.
He really is.
Oh,
you should
read all the books; they're amazing. Yeah.
Shout out to our friend Carisha. She loves Chuck Palahniuk just as much as Allie does, and she'll tell me about. You told me about some of the books he had written because she read them, and I was like, man, I should read these things. And
they're really good.
They don't have pictures, so I don't.
Yeah. No.
That's why I picked up Fight Club 2, the comic version.
I'm not a big reader, and I can sit and read those books. I mean, they pull you in.
Noteworthy of mention, pretty much every Stephen King story ever.
Yeah, they're pretty good, too.
Stephen King. It's really
just
good.
The Stephen King, who is actually Reba McEntire.
Stephen King.
That is what a twist.
What a twist.
Plot twist.
We come back, we're going to get to segment 4 and talk even nerdier.
We're getting deep down the dark caverns of nerdy.
NerdThugRadio.com. Do you need help to read without pictures? Hi, I'm Joey Savage, and I had that problem. That's why I read comic books. But apparently, there's books out there without pictures. Call 1-800-HELP-ME-READ. They can help you, because they help me too. Nerd Thug Radio.
Joey Savage here. Thanks for checking out our archives for Nerd Thug Radio. Don't forget, we are live on Lone Star Community Radio every Monday from 1 to 3 p.m. If you have any questions, just reach on out to us, facebook.com/nerdthugradio, or you can follow me on Instagram, joey.savage15.
Baby, this is what you came for. Lightning strikes every time she moves.
This is what you came for.
Feel it right.
Nerd Thug Radio.
Oh yeah, feeling it.
Play that song especially for one of our guests today, Mommy Savage, one of her favorites at the moment.
Yeah, apparently when you show up, you can just start
just
demanding
song
stuff.
Requests.
Backstory: Taylor Swift.
I swear to God, you watch what you say right now.
Taylor Swift helped Calvin Harris write that song, and when he won with it, he did not thank her.
Because they're not together.
Right.
Anymore.
Backstory. Yeah.
Backstory, we are Nerd Thug Radio on IRLoneStar.com. Soon and very soon to be 104.5, 106.1 sister stations. I'm the Captain Joey Savage. He's my heterosexual life partner, Cory DLG.
I'm about to commit domestic assault.
Behind the ones and twos, it's Nico DLG.
Oh boy, guys. I don't know if it's such a good idea to do this radio show right now.
You think we should just quit?
Yeah, probably.
Wait, are you guys doing a bit right now?
No, we're not doing a bit. Is that what we're doing?
I like Kermit the Frog.
He went to it. Yeah, let's hear the Kermit.
Hermit the Toad?
Yeah, it's Hermit the Toad here.
Hermit the Toad here, guys, coming in live from the Dirt Thug Radio studio.
That's so good.
You should do a little monologue and just have Hermit the Frog and Hermit the Morty. Toad. And Morty, like, talk to each
talking
other.
Talking back and forth.
Yeah,
that would be great. Oh, we should make puppets.
Do you remember? Yeah. You're too young for this. Do you remember there was, like, that audio clip that went around? It was Bert and Ernie getting stoned together with Big Bird.
Uh-huh.
Like, I really feel like he could do, like, the modern version of that.
The modern version?
With Morty and Hermit.
With Morty and Hermit. Morty and Hermit the Toad.
Hermit the Toad here.
Hermit the Toad here.
Okay,
Hermit
so I'll make sock puppets.
Yeah, we'll do sock puppets.
And a joint.
Sock puppet theater.
I like to remind you guys, this is a family radio station. Yeah. So let's
get back to the family basics.
Don't do drugs.
Don't do drugs and go to nerdthugradio.com.
And occasionally there are funny things that happen with drugs. But don't do drugs.
Don't do drugs.
Don't do drugs.
It's dangerous.
Drugs are bad. I keep trying to tell them my acid tripping story and they won't let me do it on the show. So
no, because it's not funny.
Check out my blog soon. I'll record it and then I'll talk about it.
Someone should sing the Dare song.
The Dare? What's the Dare song?
D, yeah. Don't do drugs. A, don't have an attitude. R, I will respect myself. E, I will educate me.
I don't ever remember singing that song.
Fun note about the DARE program.
Where is
Colossal
that?
Failure.
It's not around anymore, right?
The shirts are cool.
I have the shirts.
Those who participated in the DARE
program.
Do
you have a 2X?
I don't think so.
Oh, screw you.
Those who participated in the DARE program were three times more likely to experiment and use drugs.
Didn't everybody in public school at our age in like sixth grade have to do that?
Spring didn't do a DARE program.
Oh, we did.
We did a DARE program.
Yeah.
But ours was in like...
And it was so weird because like...
probably more about meth.
Ours was in elementary school.
Ours was in the sixth grade and my DARE teacher was friends with my uncle who was a cop. So like I had to pay attention or he would like tell on me. So it really sucked.
That was the end of it. Man, look at that guy. He sucks.
Look at that guy. He has to listen in class.
Your nephew is making all kinds of drug jokes.
Who listens in school? It's dumb.
I used to love wearing my DARE shirt.
It's become an iconic like
but
shirt.
Almost like...
It's a slap
ironically,
in the face.
But anyway, the studies show that it failed as a drug program. Because
you learned about them, you're like, oh, those sound cool. Let me try that.
Yeah, the language
if I eat this,
and you're like, what? That's
if
awesome.
I eat this, I will see all kinds of crazy things? Yes, please. I'll take
So here's my one vivid memory of like an anti-drug thing that was done. We were in middle school. I think it was at Truett Middle School. I moved around a little bit in my early teens. And so I remember this guy, they had him speak to our entire gymnasium. And he was like short.
Was it Tyrone?
No, but he was like this loud, angry dude. Balls? And he just literally was like, by the end of it, covered in sweat. But the whole time he's just yelling at us that we shouldn't do drugs.
Because he's coming off of something.
Drugs. Well, and I'm actually a little embarrassed to say that I was under the influence of some drugs at the time. And I was all I could do to not just laugh at this guy.
I mean, he was coming off of something
story.
Too if he's sweating like that.
Well, no, he was like he's one of those, you ever... We're now all older, and you encounter those people who were, like, way too proud of an embarrassing thing.
Yeah.
That was him. He was super proud to be, like, a recovering crack addict.
Thank
like,
God this
so
is,
proud
like...
Okay, kind of off subject, but did you ever see that video with the cop that was like, oh, don't handle guns, bad man? He's, like, in a classroom, like, screaming at these kids about
and
guns,
he
and he
himself?
Whips this gun out, and he shoots himself in the foot?
Yes.
Thank
but
goodness,
he was, like,
Nico.
Proud of being a thug.
This is like segment four, where only like 5% of the audience still listens. Since we're talking about don't do drugs, kids.
Don't do drugs, kids.
Don't.
It's dangerous.
Don't take DARE.
Drugs are bad. Okay.
Yeah, it's. I just think
Scruff
it's really
McGruff,
funny.
McGruff,
this,
take
this
a bite of
recently about the DARE program and it
don't
was
do drugs.
Remarkably ineffective.
The war on drugs never ending.
No, that's how they make their money.
That's right. There we go.
So what do we want to talk about, guys? We got some time.
Well,
left.
Nico has some good stuff.
A lot of
to
YouTube
about.
Changes. If you go on YouTube, there's a lot of videos trending right now talking about the new YouTube like changes in their terms of service.
YouTube
has a service; they can change everything, you know, at their leisure. But a lot of people are getting their videos demonetized due to videos being quote not advertiser friendly.
Okay, that totally makes sense.
No, but the reasons is that they would put like in the description like. may contain sensitive subjects, even if there's not graphic images shown.
Try to save talk themselves, about graphics.
No, but the main issue is like news people on YouTube are getting like their videos demonetized because they're talking about like they're breaking like a news story that's happened recently.
Okay.
And yeah, they'll talk I'm about it and they'll get their videos demonetized. But like some of these people, that's like their entire careers. They go on YouTube, but like it's not just one person. It's just like they're all over
How
YouTube.
Many people make a crap ton of money just YouTubing?
A lot.
It's ridiculous.
So okay, here's the
let
thing
me open these toys real quick and make millions of dollars.
Well, here's the thing about YouTube that I'm okay with. YouTube sort of, it lets the market prove the product. So what you're talking about is there's a guy who he would have his kids open a toy and talk about it. And he would film them discussing the toy.
He would literally film them for like 20 minutes playing with the toy.
Right. Okay, but it turns out it's incredible feedback for a toy manufacturer.
Yeah. Correct.
And it's also incredible feedback for parents with kids similar to that one. Mm-hmm. So suddenly there's a market for this show. It's not a big enough market to put it on network TV on Tuesday mornings, but there's enough that I can that he can make a living creating these 20-minute videos.
A very healthy living.
Right. And that's I'm okay
six
with
figures.
That stuff.
They came out saying like
is that child
six
labor?
Figures.
What do you think?
When the kids are homeschooled and that's probably all they do, I think it would be considered.
Yeah, it's probably. It probably is. But there's actually like the laws for child adult managers of children actors are really in the parents' favor conveniently.
Oh, yeah. Conveniently.
Like the allegedly. Parents are allowed to act as managers and take a standard like 18%. So even so if all the money is supposed to be
but isn't
for
that
the,
like exploiting your kids? You're putting your kids
it's
on
completely
the internet.
That's why a lot of
with full access to child predators. I mean, how hard could it really be to find out where these people live when they're giving points of
no. Well, very true. Yeah. Well, but I mean, it's
valid point.
It completely opens the door though to take advantage of the child. Nick Carter.
Mm-hmm.
The younger brother, Carter. Is it Nick or?
Yeah. Okay. No, it's Aaron.
Aaron Carter. So there's a show I like to watch. I love to watch the business shows on like the MSNBC.
God.
And one of them is where the guy takes over the finances for the household. And he teaches them how to balance budgets and do all the different stuff.
All
and,
stuff like, that should be taught in high school, right?
All stuff that modern high school should teach you how to write a check. It doesn't. Teach you how to pay bills. It doesn't. Teach you about the real
an
world.
Envelope.
It doesn't. It, all these things that you
write
just,
in cursive.
Budget
balance
money.
How to eat a hot dog properly.
He shows this guy subscribes to the 50-20-30 rule, which is 50% of your income should go to bills, 20% to entertainment, 30% to savings. Or it might be 20% to savings, 30%
to I should follow that rule.
But the 50-20-30 rule is how he balances household economics. Well, he sat down with Aaron Carter, and the first words out of Aaron Carter's mouth is, in the past 2 years, in the beginning of his career, he earned something like $45 million. He filed for bankruptcy when he turned 19 years old because his parents had so badly mismanaged his finances.
Jesus. What happens is, and that shouldn't even happen because his older brother had already gone through this mess.
Well, essentially what happened was...
Yeah, they almost went bankrupt, too. I don't know if
right.
he ever did.
I just don't, like...
Well, what happened...
It's understandable when you have parents who kids become famous overnight, and they weren't famous, and they didn't have money,
and they
and they mismanaged the money.
But this is kid number two.
Yeah, this is kid two. Like, you saw the older kid, you should know what's going on.
Well, and the problem
hire yourself a money man and be okay
Well, and I think
it.
The problem was the parents thought they were doing what's best for the kids, but they failed. The kids were close enough in age, though, they could make the same mistakes twice, though. At the
They're
same
not that
time,
close
probably.
In age.
They, I think they are actually like Aaron Carter. You'd be surprised
how
old he is.
Mommy Savage, look it up.
But
Nick Carter and Aaron Carter.
Basically, what happened to the show though is he honestly confesses to the guy. He said, "Listen, I had a choice to make when I was only 19 years old. I could have sued my parents, but in order to sue them, I would have had to ask
He's
the
my
state."
December 7th, 1987.
That's pretty close.
I am 2 days older than him.
Then nice. Which one, Aaron right. Carter?
No, that's Aaron Carter.
How old is Nick Carter?
I don't know that yet.
Go.
So he confessed that he had to
Tough
to sue them. He would have had the state press
36
criminal charges.
They're like 10 years apart.
Yeah, they're
10 years
apart.
Oh wow. Okay, so the parents are just awful.
Nick Carter was Backstreet Boys.
Yeah, one of the boy bands. And then
Backstreet
Aaron Carter
Boys.
Was Aaron Carter actually voices one of our characters on Young Justice that we love.
Yeah.
So
he
really
tried to do the singing thing and didn't really work.
Well,
out
no, actually, that's actually still what he's doing on the show when the guy came and took over his finances and stuff. And he makes a living doing it.
He made him some money a hot minute.
Yeah,
and then he grew
he
up.
He still makes a living. He's like touring now full time, and he is working on a new album. But none of that's relevant to what I was talking about, which was he had to choose between pressing criminal charges against his parents at the age of 19, or just swallowing their debts as his and filing the bankruptcy.
Take one for the team, bruh.
And that's what he did. Although his parents didn't show up at all in this episode, they didn't even come to support him for his local gig.
But
there.
He's got a sister too.
The sister was there helping him.
Yeah, there's like because there was that one show like the Carters,
right?
Which is always weird to watch. It's like a train wreck.
And that money they also lost.
Yeah. So, Nico, let's talk about something else you watched on YouTube recently.
I think they're from Florida, so I think that that kind of explains.
Something we haven't, man,
Florida,
we haven't, we
Florida,
haven't
Florida's talked. Not right.
No. No, there's something wrong. There's something in the
there's
water.
There's something in the
there.
Water, yeah.
Something in the water.
Right
Florida,
now.
Something in the water.
Something in the water.
So we haven't talked HeroClix too much here in the last
couple segments.
A
couple
lot
shows.
Of segments. Yeah. I mean, it's probably been at least 10 we've actually devoted more than 5 minutes to it.
Wow, okay. That's impressive.
So recently there was the U.S. and the Canadian World Cup.
Yes.
HeroClix, which is not HC Realms.
World Open.
World Open, which is sanctioned by WizKids themselves, right?
No, I believe this one's ROC.
Yeah,
so,
the opens are no.
This is because we went and played in that one event
ROC
in Austin.
ROC does the state and national champions.
Yeah.
Oh,
this is what we went to Austin that one weekend with Donnie Utah.
Yeah, that was a WizKid event.
That was a WizKid event.
I know that was a WizKid event.
Yeah, that's what this was leading up to.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
So you watched the finals.
I watched the finals and I watched some of the other rounds in them.
So who was in the finals? Do you know either one of those guys' names?
God, I don't. Remember.
You start talking about it. I'll see if I can find it.
Okay, so the
WizKids.
Yeah, the WizKids World Cup there. But mainly, it was
such a good idea, Nico.
I was making the joke. I was like, it's just about cheating really well.
Well, here's the thing about HeroClix. Okay, we'll get to it real quick. You kind of judge your own match.
Yeah, it's a gentleman's sport.
It's a gentleman's sport.
Chess.
There is an active judge. So if you have a question, you call him over. But nonchalantly, you're playing one another, and you kind of judge each other. And so if you're in the heat of the moment and you're not sure what's going on,
right.
You can miss some things.
Right, but I want to kind of guide this conversation here because I have some very specific questions I want to get to.
Go ahead.
So, okay. Nico, you said, we were talking about this, you said essentially it was like a how-to on cheating.
Yeah.
You said that the winner actually made several illegal moves.
Several illegal moves that would have not, like, would have been able to, that led to his victory.
Okay, so what exactly did you see that you were like, what?
So... ID card characters. It's people that you can call in for a turn.
Right.
He calls in the Nick Fury. You can't carry ID characters, to my knowledge, to my extent of my knowledge.
Why couldn't you?
You can't carry them.
Why?
I think is there
no, you ruling? Can carry them.
So if you can carry them, it's not that big a deal for that one. But like
you can carry them. It's just if you call in an ID figure and they become five squares or
no,
more
know,
away from
the
person,
they're
gone.
Square rule.
But yeah, you can carry them.
So
if you carry them, you can't give them any actions.
Correct, and they're gone.
Right.
But yeah. If they have like enhancement or like some. If you call in Nick Fury, for instance, I guess, and you carry him, then he could take away a power. Is that what he was doing?
Yeah.
Okay.
So he's using his power to take him away, and then on several occasions he sidesteps multiple times with the same characters in a turn. So
yeah,
that leads to multiple.
You can't do the same action more than once.
Right. That's cheating.
So he would like sidestep. Like there's one game where he sidesteps and then he's like, oh, was I here? And then he sidestepped again, and led to like an attack.
And that fills on purpose.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, like,
so what
like,
were the teams? Do you remember the teams?
The team that won was Frogman, Mr. Mixaplick.
like the Mizzy. I can't find anything on this.
Two Atoms, the Atom,
okay.
The Giant Colossal.
Colossal from Superman Wonder Woman.
Yeah.
Colossal Retaliation. Best 15 points you can spend in a HeroClix game.
Pretty much.
Doesn't seem that way.
Two Ultron Drones, and then there's one other character on their team. I already said, no, that's it. And then it's just like a bunch of ID cards.
What about the other guy?
The other guy was playing... The game I saw that was definite cheating in was he's playing two War Wheels, two Nick Furies.
Oh, wow.
And then some ID characters.
300 points?
Yeah.
So that's 120, 122, 40. How much are the War Wheels?
I think they're 20.
So 40.
And then he had a couple ID cards.
Okay. Yeah. How was he cheating?
I
can't find any information on the final match.
It's the U.S. Open. I think it was the Las Vegas, Las Vegas tournament.
Swipe left.
Okay. Attempting to use Frogman has a knockback ability.
Where's Frogman from?
Spider-Man, new set.
How can they use the new set?
It's illegal.
Yeah,
it only happened a couple days ago.
Well, when a new set drops, you have to wait so many days before you can use it.
Yeah,
no, after,
been out
that's
for
after
like
the
a
pre-release.
Month.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, pre-release, you can't use them in tournament for like the month till it actually comes out.
Right.
Okay.
Even though the pre-release didn't happen, it still counted.
Okay,
yeah.
All right, fair enough.
But when the set came out, everyone it was legal. So when he was using like the Frogman, he would like attempt to use this knockback multiple times a turn. I mean, that could just be a mistake, but I mean, like
it could just be the fact it's a new character; they don't know him very well.
Well, he's got a very
simple. You're in the finals,
but if you're in the finals, okay. So if you're the guy and you're not understanding, you say judge, you bring him over, you get it explained.
But it's clear he knows his power because it's kind of interesting the way he acts. Personally, just like viewing it, he's so hard on rules and it's on opponent's turn. Then his turn, he's like so scatterbrained and he's like Like, take it's like, an act. Like 12 minutes of he's trying to like 12 minutes a turn like talking
out his nose. I hate those people, man.
So
I hate people that take forever. They're like,
that's the kind of that's the
oh, you know what, I'll just clear. Okay, guy.
Yeah, literally, like, the first turn, I think he took, I think it was 8-10 minutes, and literally all he did was, like, TK him here, call in Nick Fury, carry Nick Fury, you can't use that. Oh, that's it. That's my turn.
Done.
Like, that takes, like, 10 minutes.
What would be the point of doing that right away, unless he was just calling Nick Fury multiple times?
No, like, he, like, the other, his opponent carried two Nick Furies up, and then he had two War Wheels, and then two Nick Furies, and then one of the Nick Furies said, like, Jean Grey can't use TK, so he got one of the, he called in Nick Fury, carried him over, said he can't use his can't use ability. Just all kinds of stupid. So you could use TK.
Bunch of rickamarole. Okay.
Yeah. So it was really.
You played some HeroClix recently. You know, we should probably talk about right now Space Cadets Con.
Cadets Con.
We just recently
we
did.
We could.
You just recently. Cadets Con happened a couple of weekends ago. We were there. It was a great time. We met a lot of cool people. Tony Fleix, a great artist, came over and
Shout out to the guy who looks identical to Ben Kenobi. Jesus Christ.
Oh, that guy's pretty good.
Yeah. Oh, I had to do a double take. I was like,
yeah. So yeah, Tony Fleix, big artist there. He did a one-liner. You'll hear that in the next show. But yeah, the guy looked just like Ben Kenobi.
And as a matter of fact, he had the personalized license plate that says B. Kenobi.
Awesome. Very awesome.
cool guy.
Sadie Savage cosplayed as Rey from Star Wars. They took a picture together. It was pretty
tied
awesome.
With our boy Arlo.
Yeah, where Arlo and Sadie won the kids costume contest cosplay. Ooh. She also made the front page of the Conroe Courier.
Oh, yeah. Why didn't... Oh, because I didn't email them to you. Say, why didn't we use Arlo's intro?
We'll use Arlo's coming up. So if you saw the Conroe Courier from Space Cadets Con, that's my kid on the front. That's her.
Yeah.
So we met a lot of cool people. You played some HeroClix. You introduced Angry Zach.
I did. I introduced Angry Zach into the game of HeroClix.
And it's mystery box segment for him.
Yeah, he was so excited. He's like, you didn't tell me it was a mystery box type of deal. I was like, yeah, there's like no who could be inside.
Yeah, so how did Angry Zach do playing?
He just missed everything. He was just getting upset because every time, like, he would actually make, like, decent moves. Like, hey,
he's a smart feller.
Yeah, and he's learning everything, so he's, like, remembering all
and
the
And he was just missing his dice rolls?
Yeah.
There's like nothing more defeating than setting up, like, awesome combos and moves.
I hate it.
And then missing your dice roll. Especially when you need to roll, like, a 5 or a 6 or better. You're like, I got this, man. And then it's, like, 4.
And especially in, like, big matches because time is a factor.
Yeah.
So you don't have the luxury of, like, I'll make this up down the road.
Well, and time not even being a factor, but just the sense. A lot of these big tournaments, I mean, you lose one and you've got a hard way to get in.
Yeah,
you know, if you're playing at home, we play friendly matches, we miss stuff, we have fun, so whatever. But when it's in big times,
I was listening to a podcast recently, and it was
which podcast you want to shout them out?
Yeah,
which one?
I can't remember the name, but it's run by Majestics CCG,
okay,
which is a store up in, I think, towards Canada.
World champion Patrick.
Yeah, they were talking about it, and it's like, oh well, dice rolls don't matter. Like, you can't blame a game on dice rolls. I was like, it totally matters. Yeah.
No, you of course you can blame it. You of course.
That's why.
They were talking. They were like, he's like, I have several world championships, and like never once have I been like, oh, I just didn't get my dice rolls that game. It's like, there's been entire games where I've made 16 attacks, nothing's hit, and then like my opponent, like it's, I'm not so salty. Like my opponent hits everything, that's fine. But like, there's certain points where it's like, I literally land nothing, how is that my fault?
It's still a game of chance. Just like when people say the cards don't matter in poker. No, the cards do matter to an extent.
You get dealt double queens in the last round. You're like, all right.
Because there's people who just are catching cards and making good moves. And there's people who don't catch cards and they can be the best player in the world and they just can't make it happen.
Right.
So the dice rolls do matter. What happens is, though, is just like cards, you put yourself in a position to give yourself
the best odds. Yeah,
you make the best move possible.
You play the odds. You're like, okay, I got this combo working up. All I've got to roll is a 4 or better, and I'm going to cripple this guy. And then you roll the 3s, and you're done.
Well, I'll never forget you and I, Nico, playing when you had the Sandman team with the Protector.
Yeah.
When we play tested that team, Nico beat me in a row 3 or 4 times.
Right.
And then when we played the day of in the tournament, we drew each other, unfortunately. Round 1 or 2, I believe.
Yeah.
Round 1, right?
And Nico missed every attack, and I hit every attack and hit him, like, strongly, crits and things like that. And the game was over in 10 minutes.
Yeah.
And I had one of those matches where I beat Nico in 10 minutes in a big tournament.
But it's just...
kind of fun. Sorry,
my team was so bad.
Sorry, Nico.
But it's the Sandman team, like we said, when we playtested it, it played out strong.
Yeah, an Avengers theme, right?
Avengers theme.
But when you don't hit your rolls,
it can go bad for you. It can go bad for you.
You're not going to do anything at all.
And it's definitely come up against me. Famously, when we play in these big tournaments, I always draw one of the top players in the first round.
Was it Zach Coffey that game?
No. Yeah, I drew Zach Coffey. the last one, and then it was Ronnie Molina before that, world champion Paris Gordon, I've drawn him in the first round. Texas State champion Joe Gutierrez, I've drawn him in the first round. Those are like my five big tournaments. I've drawn those five people.
Yeah. You know what I hate?
And then I have to climb my way back up.
Right, and that's hard. That's hard to do in a tournament. But you know what I hate is walking away from a match after it's over and realizing the one thing you could have done that would have won it.
Right.
Famously, when I was playing Paris's father, and we were essentially at a stalemate, but he was 5 points ahead of me. But on the map, we were at a stalemate, we both thought. And he was like, listen, I'm not going to engage. I'm just going to walk away.
You could have shot down for the time.
And there was a spotlight. There was an object still on the map.
Yeah.
And so I could have destroyed the object.
And that would have put you
in. That would have tied us, which would have forced
us. That was such a crazy tournament because he had just played me the round before. And we had kind of gotten to that point where the only way he could have beat me was we both had one character left. I took out the spotlight. And the only way he could have beat me is if he took out my character. And I just kept running around the map. We were playing like
that's
tag.
Probably how he knew to run away from me.
And so then he got to you the same gritty type match. But yeah, and Zach Coffey, take nothing away from the guy. He's a great player. But when I came away, I was like, you know what? I missed that one. Like I missed my own power. Had I remembered to do that at that exact time, I would have beat him.
Oh, that's right. I remember that now because Kyle Rayner was almost clicked out.
Yeah, when that stuff happens, you're just like, ugh.
Those are the ones that suck. Those are the ones that your world champion can say, oh, dice don't matter.
Yeah, because I don't mind getting beat. I hate beating myself.
Right.
Yeah.
When you beat yourself, that's when
you make a mistake, it's clear. But like when it's you know, it's like I literally missed every attack in the game.
Yeah, you can do about that.
I literally swung at the same science police officer for five times in a row with the Hulk,
so,
and I missed every attack.
Ugh.
So we also, we met a cool little group. Their table was sitting right next to us, the Texas D20 girls.
Yeah.
Well, shout out the Texas D20 girls. DLG, you spent more time with them than I did. Tell us about, what is the D20 girls? What are they?
So it's a kind of interesting program. Essentially, they're an organization that advances not just girls in gaming, like not just the idea that girls play games.
So they provide a safe place for women to come nerd out.
Right.
Right.
But they also encourage and try to support financially girls building games.
Building games or just building any kind of nerd.
Right.
Related, and they help them find jobs and stuff like that as well.
So it's a really interesting idea. I love they were a lot of fun. We played a pirate game called Booty.
Yeah. So the D20 girls are like, hey, you want to play this game Booty? And Corey's like, yes, I'm in.
Yes, sign me up right
and
now.
It seemed like a pretty interesting game.
It was interesting.
Slow
it was,
moving.
It was like a pirate negotiation game.
Parley. You had to parley.
Right. You had to parley.
Parlay?
Nope, parley.
Parley. Parley.
When you're a pirate, you're parley. When you're a non-pirate, you want to parlay with
right.
the pirates.
Ah.
Angry Zach, shout out. He taught us that.
He did. Oh, he taught
wow.
us that.
And lost a lot.
And he
dial.
Travels a lot, so. What was that game he was playing?
Logic Dial.
So, to the con, if you get on Cadets Con page on Facebook, they have their own page, or see anything mentioned about it, they kept, you know, shouting us out because we brought this cool Sega Genesis and a TV with us. So people kept coming over wanting to play the Sega. And there was a game on their Logic Dial. Very simple game. Nico, describe the premise of the game.
So it's a square box. You can only turn these. There's a 1 through 16. You have to get them in order. And
1, 2, 3, 4 on the top, and then
4, yeah.
four more rows. 3 more rows.
Three more rows after that, and you can only turn the numbers to the right, and you have to select four.
Sections of four.
In square of four.
And so Angry Zach, he sat down as Zach Attack to play this game.
He
got through the first four rounds fairly easy by turning one thing. And then he hit the fifth round, and he sat there for an hour and a half, never beat it, and turned into Angry Zach.
Couldn't figure it out.
And
could not.
It was so awesome to the point where me and Nico just started walking around and being like, hey, Angry Zach's in the back playing Logic Dial. If you want to see somebody get really mad,
go
back
there and
check him out.
If you want to see the hardest game in existence, go watch Logic Dial played by Zach Attack.
And it's funny because it's a simple puzzle game.
Right.
But you have to spin the numbers. They only go in one direction, and you're trying to get them in order. From 1 through 16, and you can only spend 4 at a time. So he would always get it to where he was only one out of place, and then he would be stuck.
It's like the Rubik's Cube.
Yeah, it's like a Rubik's Cube.
Yeah, he kept solving five sides, and he was losing his
mind. At one point, it was so funny because he was in it about 25 minutes, and he's like, oh my gosh, I'm about to solve it, and then realized the number 5 was all the way in the bottom left-hand corner, and he had totally forgotten about it.
Why?
Because he had like 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Oh my gosh, what am I doing?
So one of the greatest things is he's like, I can only turn it one direction. He's like, there's got to be a button I'm missing here. He presses the B on the controller. restarts the entire game.
It has to start over. And that's like and after an hour and a half of going at it.
And then he's like, okay, so B is beginning of the game. Thank you.
So Cadets Con was way fun. We met so many cool people, a bunch of cool artists.
It'll be a returning thing.
Yeah, we'll be there again next year. We met Megan Morris. Me and Zach did. She's a author from Spring, Texas. She wrote a book called Stardusters. Catch it out on Amazon. It was like $5.99 if you buy it on your Kindle or the Amazon Marketplace. I've gotten about 4 chapters in so far.
Yeah,
I'm actually reading a book with no pictures.
Wow.
Did you learn how to read?
She was very influential, obviously. Right.
Well, she said it was about Doctor Who, and Zach was kind of building up like it was kind of good, and it's about like time travel and like fantasy stuff.
Okay.
But I'm 4 chapters in, and I'm depressed because it's a very sad story starting out. Is it? We'll see how it goes.
Well, if you'd like, I'll let you read the story I wrote. It's called Crop Dusters.
I'll read that.
And it's only one paragraph long.
Oh, man. Are there pictures?
There are no pictures, but it's what I did right before we started the segment when I walked by.
Oh, okay, cool. Very cool. Yeah. We also met probably one of the coolest young people that we've met in a long time.
This kid was so cool.
Arlo.
Yes,
this kid's done more in his short life than I did in my entire life.
Yeah, he has accomplished more in his life than Nico has accomplished.
Well, not to mention I was being roasted the entire day, but I mean,
that's true.
I'm very roasted. I'm very all of you.
Yeah,
how is that
wait a minute. Were we roasting you, or were you getting your just desserts for dumb things you had done all week?
True.
Yeah, very true.
But I felt roasted,
Nico. Did I sign the back of that check?
Yes. Okay, so funny story. I recorded this conversation, and maybe we'll get to play it at one of the shows. But DLG, tell the story about this check.
At the DLG Casa, they have like a room full of boxes. That's just stuff they've accumulated over the years. They're starting to break it down. They're getting rid of it. They want the space back, so they're getting rid of these boxes little by little. Well, they're going through one of the boxes, and I get this text message from my dad. And it says, hey, I came across one of your old paychecks. You know, what do you want me to do with it? And I was like, all right, well, just go ahead and send it my way, and I'll deal with it. So in my head, I'm like, man.
It was like a $100 something check, right?
It was like
right?
$115. I couldn't think of a time.
It was like 2 years ago, maybe?
Yeah, and I couldn't think of a time back when I was delivering pizza, because back then,
every penny counted
twice. Yeah. So like, I couldn't think of a time where I'd be like, oh, $100, I'll deposit this later.
Yeah, later.
So I was like, man, this is really weird. But dad goes, okay, well, I gave it to Nico. When you see him, he'll have it. I said, cool. So Nico, we do the show. He forgets to bring it, but I'm going to see him the next day at the con. So I said, hey, Nico, do me a favor. Text me a photo of the front of the check so I'll call the pizza place to get him to reissue me a new one if I haven't deposited it. So Nico says, cool. He sends me a photo of the front of the check. I then ask, because he had to flatten the check to take this photo.
Correct.
I then ask, hey, did I happen to sign the back of this check? Because that will tell me right away if this check is even worth, because it's probably already been signed and turned in and blah, blah,
so
blah.
So Nico takes a look at the back of the check.
And his reply is no.
No.
So I said, okay, cool.
We get to the con.
It's driving me crazy, though. Literally all night long in the back of my head, I'm like, what was going on that this week that I didn't need?
I should write a story about this.
This is so weird. But so I get to the con, and Nico hands me some stuff, some mail that I get sent over there. It sends me.
Your dad paid one of your parking tickets again.
Oh, I love that story.
Man, we'll tell that story in a second.
Well, we'll tell that story next time.
We'll tell that story next time. So he hands me a DVD with the Luchadors that Dad was talking about on the DLG Takeover.
All three
of them are in one movie. I haven't watched it yet, but I'm excited. And then he hands me the check. So I pull the check out, and I look, and on the back, not only did I sign it.
You wrote like a paragraph.
I wrote like a paragraph because I was doing that photo deposit at the time.
Yeah,
and the photo deposit
yeah.
always requires that you write the name of the bank, the account number, and what you're doing. So it literally says my name for deposit to Wood Forest, my
account number,
like all of that is written on the back of
the
check.
And Nico just didn't see it.
I flip it and I look at it. It's a freaking essay on there. And I look at Nico and I go, Nico, I thought I asked you if I signed this. Then I'm thinking, man, I'm crazy. So I check my text messages and I said, no, yeah, you definitely said I didn't sign this. Nico goes, oh, I didn't see that.
One of the dumbest things
of
the week.
It's like a third of the back of this check is written on, and Nico's like, oh, I missed it.
Speaking of dumb things, Nico, do we have time to read some dumb tweets?
No, we're all out of time.
We're all out of time, so.
What? No. Pull the music. I'm going to do one on the way out.
We're going to end the show. Catch us at nerdthugradio.com. I'm Joey Savage. He's Cory DLG. Mommy Savage here. Nico DLG. Check out nerdthugradio.com. We end the show with Cory DLG's mean tweets.
Remember hashtag talking nerdy to you. So it's a picture of Will Smith next to a picture of young Will Smith. And the tweet says, Will Smith kind of looks like the guy from Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
That's amazing.
Is that a mean tweet or stupid?
That's a stupid tweet, and that's it's at Oscar_Vergara69. Somebody tweet this cat and explain to him that Will Smith is the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air.
Nerd Thug Radio.
Blow his mind.
Thanks for checking out this production of Lone Star Community Radio, Montgomery County's community radio station. For more information on this show and other shows on Lone Star Community Radio, check us out online at irlonestar.com. If you're interested in sponsoring a program on Lone Star Community Radio and reaching the local audience of Montgomery County on FM, internet, TV, media, please call 936-647-5747 or contact us online at irlonestar.com. This recording is a Lone Star Community Radio production produced by the show host and Dick Schischler of Lone Star Community Radio. Interested in volunteering as a music DJ or starting your own talk show? Contact Dick Schischler at dick@irlonestar.com or by phone at 936-647-5747.